I wasn't long, was I?
Not at all, Mr. Patrick.
I hope I've got my voice on straight.
It's perfect for my money.
Neff is the name, isn't it?
With two Fs, like in Philadelphia, if you know the story.
What story?
The Philadelphia story. But that's a different podcast. What are we talking about?
About the film's noir with our guest, Nora Fiore, a.k.a. the Nitrate Diva.
It's about a bunch of film noir... Films noir? Film noirs? Films noir? Film... Films? Films? Boy, that's a hundred of an anklet you got there, Mr. Patrick.
Netflix DVD presents the Cinema Shame Podcast. Log on to DVD.com to experience the perverse titillation of DVDs arriving in your mailbox. My name is James Patrick. Leave us a kindly star rating and a review because you probably didn't get me any of the stocking stuffers I asked for Christmas. Or bourbon. So to recap, a 5-star review or a really good bottle of bourbon.
Fine is not enough. No matter what you think you know, you won't get thrown. No matter how that film is shown, what always sounds the same. On the screen with five seen with no tone. You can feel.
I first met Nora Fiore at the 2015 Turner Classic Movie Film Festival. Within minutes, she'd impressed me not only with her breadth of knowledge about classic film, but also her passion and ability to dispense erudite observations without any hesitation.
I think you've overcome me with I have not already.
I have not. She's best known as the Nitrate Diva on the interwebs and has contributed commentaries to Arrow Films and Olive Films and essays to Noir City, the Film Noir Foundation's digital magazine. She has another commentary forthcoming on the next Columbia Noir set from Indicator, for the movie Tight Spot. She loves cats almost as much as she loves dark alleys and morally complicated double dealings, and she's easily one of my favorite people with which to talk about and see movies. How are you tonight?
I'm better after that intro. That made me feel all warm and fuzzy, which is not really the right place to approach film noir from, but I'll take it. That was lovely. Thank you.
It is backwards. I am sorry about making you feel all really good before you have to go discuss all those nasty people, but that's the way we do it. We make you put you in uncomfortable situations on this podcast. And since I didn't make you watch any particular movie that you've never wanted to watch, that's your punishment.
Fair enough. I'll take it.
Why did you get into film noir?
So my path into old movies in general was always a little skewed towards the dark side, I guess you might say. My first love in classic film was horror. You know, I had all the Universal Monsters VHS tapes as a little girl. And from there, I became interested in more old dark house movies, classic mysteries, crime films, Hitchcock, suspense. And by branching out, I started crisscrossing into noir. Actually, the progression from horror to noir is a really appropriate one, since you can see the shadow of German expressionism sometimes literally in both of them. And, you know, you have some directors who move from horror to noir too. You know, Edgar Ulmer does The Black Cat, then Detour a decade later. Robert Siodmak does Son of Dracula right before this incredible run of 40s noirs. But personally, my love of noir has two phases. At first, when I was a teenager, I watched a lot of the heavy hitters, Out of the Past, which remains one of my favorite films, Laura, Gilda, Double Indemnity, The Big Sleep. I got hooked on Orson Welles after watching The Lady from Shanghai. And that was a big part of what made me interested in studying film. So I was actually obsessed with The Third Man for a while. If you need proof that I was always a geek, I put the whole cuckoo clock speech from The Third Man on my senior page in my high school yearbook.
The whole speech.
The whole speech.
The whole thing.
Kind of a red flag, huh? Right?
I had a quote from LA Story, and I had a Darth Vader quote on my senior page, just as a point of comparison.
We're the real cool kids. Time has vindicated us.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was kind of like the first phase of my noir love that grew out of my love of horror. And I, you know, got immersed in some of the big names of film noir. I thought, oh, I like noir. But then in the past few years, I've kind of fallen in love with noir all over again, corny as that sounds, by moving beyond the heavy hitters and sometimes going to some sketchy websites to find some of these lesser known films. You know, I started to get into these deeper cuts, especially the B noirs or low budget movies like The Threat, Night Editor, Quiet Please, Murder. That's an odd one with George Sanders in this kinky S&M relationship with Gail Patrick. So there's a seedy, unwholesome energy to some of these B noirs that just knocks your socks off. You emerge from them asking, What did I just see there? Did I just see that? I must be imagining that. There's no way they would do that in a movie from 1947. You know what I mean?
Well, there's always a few of those moments if you're paying close attention. That, you know, we talked about this, is that you wanna pause just to really, really decide whether they went there. And mm-hmm. if you have to ask, they usually did.
Oh, they usually did, yes. And I know we've discussed this. Incredibly sophisticated dialogue that these filmmakers were having with the public, where they know just what they can show so that it jumps into your imagination without them having to break any censorship laws or put anything in the script that's going to get them in trouble. But it's this delicate dance that they're doing with our minds and sort of making us worse people in the process. That for me is a big part of what is film noir.
I think, like, you mean better people.
Well, you know, I
more
guess
more well-rounded.
Exactly. Well, it's kind of expanding your soul into maybe some places you want your soul to take a shower after venturing into. So yeah, a movie that had a huge impact on me in getting fired up about noir, as you say, it was Decoy, which is this monogram crime flick that is absolutely bonkers. And I saw this a couple of years ago. It is a pure slice of Poverty Row lunacy. This gangster mall brings her man back with a chemical after he dies in the gas chamber, and then she kills him again and goes on this wild nocturnal road trip to dig up his loot. This was made in 1945. This obscure British actress, Jean Gilly, burns through this movie. So I watched this a couple of years ago, and I thought, holy hell, how had I never heard of this movie before? It was short, but with like a zillion plot twists and all this subtext. And if I had to pinpoint the movie that fueled my desire to watch as much noir as I could get my hands on, that was probably the movie. And I had a bit of a similar experience just last year with a movie that I know I recommended to you and you watched, which was The Devil Thumbs a Ride. That one knocked me flat. That had one of those moments that you kind of go, what did I just see here? That can't just happen. No, wait, there's got to be an explanation. Oh, there's no explanation for that. Okay, wow. They're really going with that one, huh? Oh, gosh, that's dark. So these movies that are pushing the envelope with what they can get away with. Since then, these B-noirs that have a feverish quality that stays in your head have been sort of, I'm always chasing that high of trying to find a B-movie that I've never heard of that has that similar frisson of the forbidden about it, where you just watch this and go, really, they really did this. But across the years, I've also run into all these excellent noirish films that I think just aren't as well known as they ought to be for the quality that they have. You know, B films are even sometimes very prestigious productions, you can tell, with big stars, but they were unavailable or hard to see for so many years. You know, one I think about is Alias Nick Beale with Ray Milland, this supernatural noir that is so engaging around this Faustian theme of in the sphere of politics, a very timely film, great film, Alias Nick Beale. You know, one I ran across last year also was a film called Highway 301, which is a stunningly violent and rough gangster film starring Steve Cochran that about halfway through morphs from this hard-boiled heist movie into this woman in peril movie. So there's just a huge amount of noir out there that isn't going to make it into the top 10 list or even the top 20 list. It's not extremely well known, but it's just, it's a whole jungle out there to explore. And I just find that the more I get into it, the more excited I am about it.
That's the high, isn't it, though? Like, you're talking about chasing those obscure, those novelties. I mean, that's what what this is all about, really, is that we crave that discovery. It is really is chasing the dragon.
I love it.
When you get that, you know, you feel that. It's like, I feel like I'm the one discovering this movie for the first time. Clearly other people have seen it. But in that moment of time, you've never heard the movie until that minute. Like, you just stumbled across it somehow. Somebody, you know, through an actor or through a director. And you're seeing something in this movie that maybe other people haven't seen. And that is a high. It really is a high.
Mm-hmm. Yes, or maybe you see something in it that other people haven't seen, or you just sort of had this moment. For me, it's more like this moment of total kind of union with people who made this so many years before you, because what you're reading into it isn't on the screen, but you're getting their intent, and it's almost like this telepathic message coming to you, this very seedy, unhealthy telepathic message coming to you from another time. You're sharing this like bond of complicity with some very sick people who made some very sick movies. But you know, I think there's the discovery angle of it that is so appealing. But for me also, it's the rediscovery that, you know, you start to see these patterns after you've watched. Once you broaden your noir vocabulary, you start to see patterns, like, and you start to collect movies in little groups in your mind. Like for me, the girl sleuth noir, you know, movies like Deadline at Dawn or Lured, or even something more obscure like Destination Murder, Black Angel. You know, the more you look into these films, we're all weaned on the figure of the private eye. We're all expecting the male detective, but the more you look into these films, you discover that there's this strong through line of female investigators and women on the case, women spurring on investigations. So the more you delve into these films, the more patterns that come out to you. And another phenomenon that I find rather wondrous is the more time you spend with B movies, the more you appreciate A movies. Like, for instance, Double Indemnity was not a film that ever really lit me up when I was first discovering noir, but the more I watch some of these gritty B productions, the A picture qualities of Double Indemnity really shine to me and impress me. And I can get a balance between both. You know, after slumming with some of these low budget, gritty films, you can go and spend time with some of the more glossy noirs, and they're both noir, but there's all these different flavors within noir that have really revitalized my appreciation of it. The more I get into it, the more I love it. And then I also think the more you explore an actor or a director or a cinematographer, it definitely deepens your appreciation of the little tricks they do or the ways that they have arranged. You know, I enjoy Born to Kill a lot more after having seen The Devil Thumbs a Ride. Or once you've seen a little B movie like Desperate, you know, Anthony Mann's little crime film made at RKO, Steve Brody isn't just the guy who plays Jeff's loser partner in Out of the Past. You know that he has this range, that he could be a hero, he could be a loser, he could play all these different kinds of roles. So I find that the more I get into it, the more I like it.
Some of the A-list stuff too, I think a lot of it for me is performance too, because you're dealing with the B. I mean, not to paint it with too general a brush, but the B's, you're dealing with character actors and lesser known actors who never quite made it. And the A's, you have these larger than life personalities. And there's a totally different through line when you're dealing with, you know, a Barbara Stanwyck in a lead role and what she's allowed to do in a role versus what they're allowed to do in the B movies, which was get in front of the camera and get it done. And while that nitty gritty filmmaking has its own charms in and of itself, I mean, you can't duplicate some of the pleasures of a B movie in a star driven vehicle. But in the same way, you know, you look at Double Indemnity is on the mind, and you're looking at those performances, the Barbara Stanwyck and the Fred McMurray, who's someone I've really come to appreciate now, seeing what he's able to do in not only that, but The Pushover, which he's fantastic. I mean, he anchors that entire movie, and it's a slight movie narrative wise, but it's all character. They're given a little more time and space to operate, and they really are different pleasures.
Absolutely. There's just something so direct and simplistic. It's the straight shot of genre that you get in the B movie, whereas the A film is more complex. And like you say, these big stars are able to show the nuances of their characters a little bit more. And I love Pushover. I love that you brought that up. That really is an excellent film. I mean, Fred MacMurray and Kim Novak, not really a couple that I would have put together for it, but they play off each other so beautifully in that. And there's so much sadness to that performance. There's mm-hmm. so much melancholy, and you think he's almost playing the same role as he does in Double Indemnity, but Double Indemnity is pulling on his subtext as the wise cracking, well, more his star image as the wise mm-hmm. cracking, happy-go-lucky, all-American guy. But by the time we get to Pushover, he's more the shell of that man. We kind of see him become the shell in Double Indemnity. He's the shell right from the beginning.
Yep.
Pushover. Man, that's such a great film. I'm so glad you brought that one up.
Yeah, and that's one I hadn't seen until Criterion Channel did that spotlight on the noirs 2 years ago, I guess it was. Now, right when they first started, they had that, was the
Columbia Noir.
The Columbia Noirs, right. Yeah, and that was the first one I watched, because it was one of the two or three that I really didn't know much about at all, and I was floored by that movie.
What a great collection, too. I'm so glad decided to shine a light on Columbia Noir, because there were a number in that I hadn't seen. I watched through them, I think, in chronological order, and it was fascinating to watch how, through the prism of this single studio and their stars and, you know, their cinematographer, someone like Burnett Guffey, I think, shot like half of those films, maybe more than half of those films, and just to see how they evolve over time and how the different genre tropes are complicated or in some cases simplified. That was a great collection and a great example of kind of what I'm talking about, where the deeper you get into it, the more these connections become available to your mind. I mean, noir is a pretty narrow range. It depends on how you want to define it. But if you're defining it from, say, you know, 1940 to, I don't know, 1958, let's call Touch of Evil the swan song of the real classic noir era. It's not a very long period, and that's, frankly, you know, not a huge amount of films. But the connections between them, the ways in which they're crisscrossing and just sort of taking a pretty narrow turf and yet doing all these interesting things with it is just a great pleasure for me to continue to unravel and unspool.
I went back to Eddie Muller's Dark City, The Lost World of Film Noir from 98, when I was looking up for his, like, the earliest definition that I found from him. Mm-hmm. And of course he doesn't ever pin it down either. He had one specific quotation that I want to read here, because I think it is as close as you're ever going to get and is a perfect encapsulation of what it is that we're talking about.
And by the way, Eddie would never forgive me if I didn't mention that Dark City is getting a reissue that is coming out next year.
Oh, is it? Well, that's nice for everybody.
Yes, indeed. Now go on with the quote.
Okay. They've got vivid characters and thematic weight and an inspired vision that preserves their vitality. When they fail to meet that tall order, they've got style and sass to die for. Enjoy it for the surface allure, or venture further into the scorched existentialist terrain.
Oh, I like that. Yeah, that's concise, and that's beautiful. Scorched existential terrain. I like it. That gets this sense of peril, the world that wants to betray you, but also kind of the ways you want to betray yourself. I like it.
And in the same book, he says, you can't control the way the world works, only how you choose to live within it, and calls that the film noir credo. So I think by putting those two concepts together, so the form and function of a film noir, style and sass, and then the deeper existentialism, but it's also this post-war feeling of trying to take control of your life in a world that doesn't necessarily want you in it.
Yes, and that's, you know, such a great explanation for all the trends of amnesia, or, you know, loss of identity, or some kind of swapped identity, is these people who are having to reevaluate who they are and kind of account for the ways in which they've changed, the way they've become worse than they were, kind of have to grapple with this darkness within them after having done things that they, you know, maybe never thought that they were going to have to do in their lives. Great anecdote about Joan Crawford when the French critic calls her up and starts talking about film noir style, and she has no idea what this means. And she calls Jerry Wald and says, well, what is this? What is this noir thing they keep talking about? And he tells her, and she goes, oh, okay. And she starts immediately being Joan Crawford, absorbs this concept beautifully and starts referring to Mildred Pierce as a film noir and talks about how the cinematographer, you know, she remembered him making all these little diagrams and saying, well, what are you doing there? And he had said, and she said, are those for special lights? And he said, no, they're not special lights. They're for special shadows. And she said, that is noir. So far be it from me to embellish on the grand dame's great definition, special shadows is a big part of it, but also this kind of moral ambiguity. And the concept that you're really enjoying bad people doing bad things, that you're aligned with a certain kind of forbidden pleasure, I think. I think pleasure for me is a lot of what's wrapped up in noir. If a movie's just about showing social conditions, in some ways I'm less inclined to call that a film noir. It's more of a social drama for me. For me, noir always needs to have this little frisson of, oh boy, I shouldn't be enjoying this as much as I am. I think the reason why noir does speak to every generation is because every generation has a identity crisis, you know, and noir is really one of the, arguably the first time that identity crisis was ever captured palpably on film. I mean, you do get this in the social dramas of the Depression era. You even get it after World War II, after World War I, where you start to see, you know, these stories of soldiers returning and having to readjust to life. But I feel like this question of, like, who am I really? And how am I going to cope with the fact that I've learned so much about the world and the way in which it's a place of chance and darkness and violence. Like, how am I going to deal with that? I feel like noir is really the first movement, short of maybe, you know, German expressionism, to really, like, go to the dark heart of that question. And every generation kind of has that, and that crisis within them. So I think that's part of the reason why it's just has such a longevity, right?
Not wrong. I don't think your inclination to think about that is at all wayward. I mean, you think about it, every new generation enters a world that doesn't trust them and doesn't believe in their value.
Mm.
You see it every time there's a new label placed on a generation.
Among young people who are into classic film, noir occupies this very central place in their hearts. You know, in Watergate, we found out that, you know, the government was bad and all this stuff. It was kind of this revelation, this realization that sparks paranoia. We've been there, you know. It's been the ambient culture of my generation, is just kind of basic distrust of everything, and kind of we're surprised when we find out someone isn't out to get us. And I think that that's part of the reason why noir resonates so well with kind of younger classic film fans, especially. I mean, although with all of them in general. Does that make sense? I don't know. Tell me about your generation. Was that already there for you?
So I get to lay claim to the wonderful Gen X. We were brought
Baby,
into.
I don't care. We I'm were sorry. Brought. Heard Robert Mitchum saying that. Go ahead. Carry
we
on.
We were brought into existence, kind of feeling certain ways we reacted against it by not trying. I think there's a gap. Like, I'm kind of on the cusp, but I still fall into X. And when you start getting into that next generation, there's an impetus to act and be vocal that I didn't experience growing up. And even into college, like, we were our own entity, and everybody else can kind of, I mean, not to be totally crude, but suck it.
Well, that's a pretty noir attitude, too.
We're going to listen to our Cure records, and you can do what you want.
Mm-hmm. Out of it, above it, kind of, you know, get out of here with this. This isn't my problem.
Right. You know, again, grand generalizations about, you know,
sure,
sensing the way that you're brought up and the way that your peers act and the way that you feed off that collective consciousness. And some of it is stereotype building a reality.
Yeah,
what does this have to do with noir again?
I don't know. Who knows? I do think that, you know, parental censorship is a form of censorship, comes into the way in which we do or don't experience this content as shocking. By not showing things, it's often more shocking, by just kind of implying, like, wow, did that just mean what I think it just meant there? That, like, you like this guy because he's a killer or something like that? Like, that to me is more shocking than any, I don't know, kind of... R-rated sex scene that, you know...
It's true, because it's left to your imagination, and what you can imagine is always more and always more visceral than what they can show you on screen. Once they show it to you on screen, that mystery and the potential is gone.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And while there is a certain amount, you receive an immediate visceral reaction to something that's gory or something that's shocking on screen... It doesn't linger. It doesn't kind of dig under your skin. And like, just like you said, is that what I think just happened? And mm-hmm. that's what stays with you. I read your blog post on Devil Thumbs a Ride, and you touch upon that. Right.
Well, it has, for my money, one of the most disturbing ellipses in cinema, where just kind of, if you've seen a lot of these films, if you've seen a lot of films that are women in peril films, you know that in most cases, and I would say all cases, nothing bad happens to the good girl, right? You know, we get our kind of scary titillation and it all turns out okay. And we're left thinking, oh, you know, that was a fun little ride there. But in this one, oh, no, whatever you think is going to happen, it's much, much worse than what you think is going to happen. And you're kind of left with this, like, oh, I feel, you know, like, why am I watching this? This is really just... You know, so much, so dark.
That is what, because it happens so fast in movie time. You have to stop and really appreciate what just happened. Because, again, you're going around the production code. You are finding ways to imply and suggest to the viewer what has happened without explicitly telling them. Because, oh my goodness, that would not fly.
No, but I think... Even in these B movies, they got away with so much more, because I don't think that they were just being examined as much. I mean, it was really the scripts that they were clearing. You know, you can see that a lot with what Val Lewton could do. And I, you know, it's funny because I feel like I'm just much more into these films than, you know, my parents, who are generation older than me. And a lot of times when I'm watching them, I'm like, do you understand what just happened there? They're like, well, you know, no. And I'm like, oh, well, they're implying this, this, and this. And they're like, okay, I didn't get that. You know, it's kind of like one of these things where when we're talking about noir, you know, we talk about the directors, but I think another, you know, just kind of the complicity between the director and the audience, how much they were supposed to be able to get, how much the directors were banking on the audience being a very sophisticated lot, I feel like is something that gets glossed over a lot. And I think that sense of complicity that, oh, you know what I mean here, it makes us kind of wound up in the film in a way that's kind of uncomfortable, that, you know, it's the films are betting that the audience is not innocent, and, you know, it doesn't kind of leave you with a great feeling at the end in that sense, like you're part of this whether you like it or not.
There's also a cinematic shorthand that they're delivering, so if you're if you've become in tune to the specific cues that they're giving you, you're going to pick up on it. But if you've never recognized or sensed the patterns that are taking place, the way that they suggest action, you may just not notice. And obviously that's what they were counting on with the production code. I was thinking about this, my wife and I just got into crossword puzzles. This was our COVID activity, right? So I guess we would be considered novice crossworders. There is a shorthand clue system of repeated answers and categories and things you're just supposed to know.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've been doing crosswords for all these years, religiously, every week, every day, these answers just fly off and you see them as soon as you pick up the crossword. Meanwhile, I'm sitting there thumping my brain going, what in the world does this have to do with anything? That shorthand applies to the cinematic language as well. When they give you this cue, you just know. And now I've gone and related film noir to crosswords. I swear it applies. Do some crosswords and you'll like
I love it. I mean, I think that so much of film noir is a puzzle. I mean, from the narrative structure to this thing we're talking about where they're conveying so much through so little, through what's between the lines, you know, just the fact that so much of it has to do with either mysteries of whodunit, mysteries of the human heart. I mean, there's definitely a puzzle element to these films, you know, that they're full of enigmas, many of which are left unsolved at the end of the film.
It was the 40s, right after the war. Going to the movies was like going to a candy store, something for everybody. Popular films were melodramas, romances, musicals. The big song and dance. But that's not my kind of movie. You could always find me in a theater around the corner. People like me liked our pictures dark and mysterious. Most were B movies made on the cheap. Others were classy models with A talent. But they all had one thing in common. They lived on the edge. Told stories about life in the streets, shady characters, crooked cops, twisted love, and bad luck. The French invented a name for these pictures, film noir, black film, that's what they called them, about a darker side of human nature, about the world as it really was.
I think that's a great lead into this particular episode's impetus for existing. We've now talked about all of the film noir that we can think of as an introduction. Now, I got Nora on here because I wanted to do an episode of our first watches for Noirvember. So, like many other people, we crammed as many film noir as we could into 1 month. And I don't know how much I've watched outside this month. I do tend to save stuff for November, just like I save horror movies for October. But I wanted to pick your brain and see which new watches, keeping in tune to the whole cinema shame theme, which new watches you've regretted not seeing until right now. We decided to pick two American, was it two international, was it non-English? I can't remember what our specific credentials were for. Is it just non-American noir?
Both of mine happen to be not in English, but I think international. If it's a Brit noir, I'm not going to cry foul on you.
Well, mine are both not in English, so I guess we just sidestepped that whole problem altogether. And then I added one neo-noir, because I do think the neo-noir movement that came out of the 70s is a sort of a criticism reaction to the film noir conventions has its own charms, and I dearly love some film noir, neo-noir, that came out of the 70s, just because I think the 70s were the perfect venue for that conversation. And both in terms of where we were as a country coming, like we're talking about post-war, post-Vietnam War, there's a lot of that same disenfranchisement and you know, feeling of displacement happening.
Paranoia.
Yeah, and they're coming at it with an entirely different set of cinematic language. So we'll touch on that in a minute. But, let's see. Guests go first. So let's start with your first pick for American film noir, first watch for Noirvember.
Terrific. So one that I wanted to highlight is Framed. This is a Columbia noir from 1947.
I want to go over this from beginning to end. That sign, dangerous curve on the right. That's where I stop and where you...
I know.
It stars Glenn Ford as this ex-truck driver, sort of out of work drifter guy who gets involved with a barmaid, but she's not just a barmaid. She's actually the mistress of the town's big high roller, and he has this nefarious plan to kill some schmo, fake his death, and abscond with a big load of embezzled dough from his bank. I know there's some spoilers in there, but it's a film noir. You know this isn't going well. So Ford is the fall guy, and you know he's very good in Framed Glenn Ford, but the movie for me really belongs to Janice Carter as the femme fatale, because once she develops feelings for Glenn Ford's character, she changes the plan. She flips the script. And there's this great scene where she silently decides between which of the men of her life she'll give the coup de grace to. You know, she gets this great, you know, wordless performance, kind of just looking between the two of them, which one of you am I going to throw over? And it's just a magnificent scene. It's one of the great underrated, you know, film noir scenes that I just think people don't talk about as much as they should. And Janice Carter, she is an actress I have come to love. I think she's a real underrated noir dame. I don't think I've really felt quite so, you know, where have you been all my life since I first watched the film Decoy and saw and discovered Jean Gilley, who's this amazing femme fatale protagonist. Because Janice Carter, she's probably the noir most people know her from is Night Editor, where she's the psychopathic socialite who gets turned on by murder. I mean, she's just, it's a real all-timer of a evil, you know, twisted woman. A Night Editor is, you know, one of those great B movies I'm talking about that as you just get deeper into the catalog, you go, wow, this is some stuff. This got real. But she also could play good girls. You know, she's really cute as the resourceful girl sleuth in The Power of the Whistler. So I've been on a bit of a Janice Carter discovery, rediscovery streak, and she's terrific and Framed. She's an interesting looking woman. She looks to me almost like a noir Disney princess. Like, she's kind of this classy looking, graceful woman, but she also has this dangerous, calculated quality about her. And there's an interesting backstory to Carter. She studied to be an opera star, which is actually something I desperately wanted to be when I was a teenager. That's where the diva and Nitrate Diva comes from, actually, is that it's kind of it was my joke when I was looking for a username about my failed opera aspiration. So I feel close to Janice Carter in that way. But, you know, something I noticed about her as someone who, you know, classically trained for singing is how she holds her mouth. Because when you're singing, you build so much muscle in your lips and jaw and chin. And I feel like as a result of this, she has this fabulously wicked, expressive mouth that just gives her a look and performance style that really stands out in an era of great noir dames. So Framed, terrific, underrated noir, I think. I know it came out on a set from Imprint earlier this year with a commentary by Alan Brody, and I think it's also going to be in this next Columbia Noir set that I'm also on. So I'm sure either one of them is going to be great, and I do recommend it. It's quite a film.
Talking about Janice Carter, and if I remember correctly, the first time I knew her name was actually from a Don Ameche movie.
Really?
I had to look it up because I could not remember the name. It's Girl Trouble. She's a supporting actress in that, but she made enough of an impression that I had to look her up and see what her name was and try and get the story. But yeah, so I knew her originally from this, you know, light comedy. And once I started seeing her and I started to pick up on her in other movies that, yeah, I just hadn't registered. It's one of those things where, you know, you just never recognize the person until you finally put a name to the face, and then she starts popping up elsewhere. Not that you probably hadn't seen her elsewhere, but it's that glimmer of recognition, because then she was in Flying Leathernecks, the John Wayne movie, and she's just around, and it's like, why haven't I ever picked you out before? And Framed was actually on my list to watch for this month, but I never got around to it, so I will push it to the top because I'm still trying to finish my stack of stuff that I had planned to watch. So
I hope you like it. It's a lot of fun. I mean, there's also a grizzled prospector. I mean, how many noirs also have a grizzled prospector in them?
Not enough, just, that's for sure.
They threw so much stuff into this. It's definitely got one of those you know, don't like the plot, wait 5 minutes kind of approaches where it zigzags all over the place and has all these weird tropes that some of which you expect to see and some of which you don't. But it's a fun little film with some nifty little twists in there.
All right, so for my pick, I'm going with The Big Combo from 1955, directed by Joseph Lewis.
What's the matter with you?
What have I done now?
Before I came in when you were playing that record, what were you thinking?
I was trying to remember how I fell in love with you.
That's so hard to remember?
A girl's first love shouldn't be. It should be your only. Maybe that's why I can't leave you.
We'll talk about love some other time. Do you know what I've been doing? What's been happening?
People tell me all sorts of things. I don't listen.
I didn't ask you before. You were sick. What did Diamond tell you? Diamond. Lieutenant Diamond. Detective. 93rd Precinct. He grilled you for 3 hours in the hospital. What did he tell you?
Kept asking me about a girl.
What girl?
Her name was Alicia.
Who's she?
I don't know. He was very insistent.
What was her name again?
Alicia.
Doesn't mean a thing to me.
And this is a movie that I'd read about in, again, the very same Eddie Muller book many, many moons ago. I went as far as buying the Blu-ray when it came out. And then I just slapped it on the shelf in the stack of unwatched discs that I have, and it just sat there. Part of it was I just never recognized the title as the movie, as that movie. From, like, Muller goes into great detail about The Big Combo in his book, and I just never made the connection again. So when I was assembling my stack of must watches for this month, I saw it down on the bottom shelf, and I was like, The Big Combo sounds like a film noir. And it's on Blu-ray, so into the stack it goes. I watched it, and it was one of those, like, why? What have you done wrong that this is something that you've let sit on your shelf for so long? And then I remembered how it came about in the first place, went back and found the book and reread about it. The story goes, Lieutenant Diamond, played by Cornell Wilde, is on a crusade to bring down the exceptionally evil Mr. Brown, played by Richard Conte. Mostly because he's a real bad dude, but he's also desperately in love with the gangster's girl. Mm-hmm. That happens, you know, quite frequently. Played by Gene Wallace, who until this point I only knew as Franchotone's wife. I don't think I'd ever seen her in anything, but I knew the name connected to him. And she's actually quite good, very striking, more like a young Sybil Shepherd.
Definitely.
Our fearless lieutenant persists, and as he continues to push, every time he goes and finds another witness, Brown goes and kills 5 more people. It's extraordinary how evil this guy is. But the movie itself, I won't go too much further into the plot, because it takes some really nice twists at the end. Not ones that maybe you don't see coming, but they're really earned. So it's got everything you need, right? So I listed the thing. So it's got sexual perversity.
Oh boy, does it ever.
All coming out its pores.
To the point where, you know, the story about Cornell Wilde and Gene Wallace, right?
I don't know if I do.
Okay, well, I'm just sorry to butt in here.
No,
but it's a great
butt in all you want.
Story. So Cornell Wilde supposedly got very, very angry at Joseph H. Lewis. So he was married to Gene Wallace, you know. I know she's kind of best known maybe as Franchotone's wife, but she also was married to Cornell Wilde. And after the scene where, you know, they're doing things that the production code would not exactly be happy with, and
so
is this
the one with the where she's extraordinarily turned on while he's semi sort of raping her in a scene in a room filled with guns and money?
That would be the one. And you know, he dips out of the frame.
Right.
Take of that what you will. And Cornell Wilde he read the implication there and supposedly got quite a bit cross at Joseph H. Lewis for putting his wife in this scene with this very unfamily friendly implication.
It was one of those things I could not believe it happened. You know, he's flying into a tirade about how all these guns, it's guns and money, and he shoves her into the room, and her like eyes roll back in her head even as she's screaming at him, and then when he disappears from frame, like, oh, they did not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's one of those things where, again, you know, it's not like the suicide at the end of, you know, The Seventh Victim, because it's not in the script. You couldn't object to it, you know?
No.
Yeah, you're just seeing things there. You don't know what's happening. It's, you know, it's out of frame. So
maybe he was proposing. I don't know.
You know, maybe he saw something on the floor. He wanted to pick it up. You know, you don't know what happened there. Exactly. Yes, I'm sure that's exactly what happened.
Right. And then, if that, you know, weren't totally enough for this movie, the Mr. Brown's henchman, deliciously played by Lee Van Cleef and Earl Holliman, these guys are definitely homosexual lovers.
Not even a doubt in my mind.
My favorite line. They've been hiding out. They committed a murder, and Mr. Brown shoved them basically into a basement so they would hide out and lay low for a while, you know, the heat passed over. And he keeps bringing them food. And they say, "I can't swallow any more salami."
Wow, that's not even a wink to the audience. That's like, you know, they might as well be sending a firework into the air.
In my notes, when I was writing about the movie, as I was watching, I just wrote "Oh my" next to the quote. I mean, I didn't.
And you know, the thing I like about that too is that, you know, without giving too many spoilers, there is that it's not just there for titillation. It's not just there for let's see how much forbidden content we can fly under the radar.
It's so funny.
It also has this really poignant payoff too. You know, without giving too much away about the characters, it's not just like, oh boy, you can tell there's more to that relationship, because, you know, there's the kind of gay hitmen duo is a thing you see in a lot of these films. I mean, it's kind of implied a little bit in The Big Sleep. I watched a movie from 1930 called The Czar of Broadway. That's kind of a proto-noir pre-code gangster film where there was a pair of gay hitmen. This is a very hard to see film. I saw it at a rare film festival, similar kind of sharp dressed duo that you can tell have this relationship. And, you know, in a lot of these cases, it's for comic relief or for kind of like a wink to the audience. But I think, you know, in The Big Combo, it's not just for that. It is a relationship that has a payoff that is, you know, in some ways a very, very touching one, I think.
It is. No, they actually develop their relationship, which is something. I mean, you talk about the trope, but the trope is not often developed. Like I said, it's usually there for, you know, a giggle or a little bit of titillation if you pick up on the vibes. But in this instance, you know, you actually feel some sympathy. Like, you feel for these characters when what goes down goes down.
There's a definite sense of loss that goes with the ending, I think. And, you know, I like that it's not just all focused on the main characters and their emotions, that these characters are allowed to have an interior life and emotions that are not played for comedy. I definitely agree. It's one of the more sophisticated, you know, maybe the most sophisticated use of that trope or kind of, you know, under the radar thing in classic Hollywood.
And my next note for having everything you need is the overblown villain monologue. He's got a couple real doozies in this movie, but the one that impressed me the most is when he's berating the boxer that he employed, and he's in the dressing room after the fight when he loses, and he's reading him a certain kind of riot act. He said, "First is first and second is nobody. What makes the difference? Hate. Hate is the word. Hate the man who tries to kill you. Hate him until you see red and you come out winning the big money. The girls come tumbling after." And that's only a snippet.
You know, by a very strange coincidence, I've actually put that into counted cross stitch, and I have it on my wall right now. No, just joking. Go ahead.
There needs to be pillows with that on there.
Right? The noir motivational pillow line of quotations. I think that we could really make big money on this. We could clean up, Jay. You and me will own the world.
This is our Etsy store. I mean, it's a little late for this Christmas, but I think for next year. I mean, you could do a whole line with just Richard Conti's lines from this movie. I mean,
you could. You totally could.
And coming from that, another everything you need is the good-ish versus pure evil. Because Cornell Wilde, detective, isn't purely motivated by his want to do right by the law. He wants the woman.
Mm-hmm.
The doing right by the law is okay, too. But he's going up against what is really one of the most villainous figures I've ever seen in a film noir. I mean, Mr. Brown, like I said, scorched earth mentality.
Mm-hmm. One thing I just want to say about The Big Combo, and this is maybe a weird remark, but I feel like it is a film that is really underserved by its title. You know,
it is. And that's part of why I never watched it.
It sounds like a delicatessen, not a great movie. I mean,
I never pulled it out because it's The Big Combo. Like, what...
What combo? What I mean, maybe I'm just really missing on the gangland lingo there. Maybe it was, intended to have more of a significance in the time. But boy, it really, to me, in this day and age, it undersells that film.
It's like they were just they saw The Big Clock and was like, oh, that's an okay title. That's The Big Combos. You know, that flies the same way.
Yeah, there's a lot of bigs, just like there's a lot of knights and
big
a lot
sleep,
of cities.
Big clock.
Like the Naked City, The Cry of the City, mm-hmm. and let's throw city or big or whatever in it. And, you know, it's a noir title. It seems like it was the random noir title generator might have pulled that one out.
It's the same one that generated the latest Bond movie title, too, I swear. And I don't even know what the title means. There's no indication in the movie that there's a big combo or anything. I mean, is it just the combination, the love triangle? I don't. Whatever. Point is, you should watch further down the rabbit hole. It's a lower budget noir that uses a whole bunch of light and shadow to overcompensate for its lack of elaborate set. John Alton's camera work is really making the most of what he's got and utilizing expressionism whenever possible. There's some surreal moments where they step out of their grounded, realistic environment, and he uses the long shadows and the gothic world of the city that they live in.
Mm. Yeah, it just looks beautiful, and I love that.
Especially
the
Casablanca type ending uses the fog and the shadows of the garage, the backlighting.
Absolutely, yeah. The lighting is even a key plot point. Well, you know, at least in the end, it's kind of it is the way the light is being directed and who is directing it is this cathartic moment. So I love that the lighting is not just gorgeous and adds so much in terms of mood and texture, but it also is actually literally, you know, interwoven into the plot.
That was Big Combo 1955, directed by Joseph Lewis. Seek it out. It really should be at the top of your list if you haven't seen it. Moving on to your number two.
So my number two is a little bit of a wild card. And this is one kind of like, you know, I guess The Big Combo for you. This is a film that has been on my radar for many years. I kind of always thought I would like it. It sounded like something right up my alley. And it turned out to be literally alley because I saw it on Noir Alley just a week or so ago. And this is Suspense, which is from 1947.
And gentlemen, now I'd like to present the highlight of our show. Roberta Elva in her daring leap through the jaws of death. Now I'm going to ask every member of the audience to remain absolutely quiet for the next few minutes. Those knives are very, very sharp. And that opening is very, very small. It takes perfect coordination to perform this feat. Anything to break Miss Elva's concentration would be fatally dangerous. So let's cooperate.
And this is a flashy, unusually ambitious production for a Poverty Row outfit monogram. It's been on my radar, and I largely because of Belita, who was the ice skating noir queen. And yes, so this is the kind of an ice skating noir. You get all the hard-boiled double crosses and adultery or kind of adulterous desire and murder and, you know, faked death and all the stuff that you would want from a film from a film noir, but there are also interludes with these surreal ice ballet dances, you know, some of which are very grim in nature. You know, they're not just ballet dances, like it's not a Sonia Henney routine, you know, slipped into a film noir. The ice dances are much darker, you know, they're street scenes, or they're, you know, she leaps through a circle of knives. There are these very macabre ballet, or, you know, she's sort of in this almost reduced to an abstraction by the columns of light and shadow. So they're very dark ice ballets, and they really do elevate this film, which is, you know, the script is not the strongest, I feel like. You know, it's kind of a mess, but it's this divine mess that could really only exist in classic Hollywood, where you have this, you know, low-rank studio trying to do something big. And, like, I feel like that shows in the sense that this film is bursting at the seams with all the stuff they tried to shove into it. You know, you've got the jealous husband. You've got the unscrupulous lover. He's got a lover who's got his number, who's coming out of the past at him. He's got this ex flunky who wants to get revenge on him. It's got this business, you know, there's an avalanche. I mean, they really tried to cram every possible thing they could think of into this film. And as a result, it has this kind of dream progression from setting to setting and from plot point to plot point. I feel like the title is a total misnomer. There is not a lot of suspense in this film, actually.
If you call it suspense, I feel like you have to deliver something, do you not?
It really does not deliver that much suspense. I mean, the whole aspect of the suspense is supposed to be that Alita's husband is dead, or is he?
Maybe they should have called it the big suspense, and that would have...
that would have been a little more noirish, maybe, the big suspense, the big weight, the big fear. But no, they didn't call it any of those things. But there's really not a lot of suspense here. But there is a lot of style, and a lot of that style is coming from Charles Rocher, who was a great cinematographer. He worked on silent masterpieces like Sparrows and Sunrise. He worked on another movie that I consider kind of to be a proto-noir, The Story of Temple Drake, which is this incredibly scandalous, sordid Faulkner adaptation, which was recently released on the Criterion Channel. Highly recommend it. And you can see already sort of what he would do in noir in that film. And there's actually a scene in Suspense that, I mean, really, if you had to show someone with a single frame, like what noir is, with the Venetian blind shadows and all that, you could not do a whole lot better than what this film achieves there. It just really has that classical, you know, almost dorm room poster noir look. It's really the lighting that sold me on this film and made me include it on this list, because, as I said, it's not a great film, but it is a tremendously enjoyable film. And the other thing I really liked about it, too, is that Eugene Paulette is in it. And it's just weird to see the screwball comedy dad, or, you know, kind of the quirky Froggy Boys dude that we love, that we know and love, looks so weary and existentialist. It's a strange combination of, you know, it would be like, you know, your best friend's dad talking about, you know, how he killed someone or something. It's a weird mismatch of tones and, you know, a character actor there. Although it does have a character actor who I do know primarily from noir, and that is Albert Dekker as the husband who may or may not be dead, and he's wonderfully sinister. So that's a fun little film from Monogram that I do recommend checking out if you get the chance and you're in the mood for something just absolutely trippy and like nothing else.
Available on Warner Archive DVD as well, so it is available.
Yes, funny thing about that, I bought the DVD, but I didn't watch it, sort of like you with The Big Combo. I had it on my stack for a really long time, and then I'm like, you know, it's going to be on Noir Alley. I won't rush it. I'll wait and watch it in Noirvember. That'll be cool. And I did, and I'm glad I did, because I'm getting to talk to you about it now.
There's a theme with my picks for this episode, and you have a perfect segue into my next selection. Because Suspense was directed by Frank Tuttle. Mm-hmm. As was another one that I really should have watched by now, This Gun for Hire.
Oh, I love that film. Oh.
So you're a cop, office girl.
Who told you that?
He was here looking for you, and you'd better stay away from me.
Veronica Lake, who burst on the screen like a blonde bombshell, Alan Ladd, who's dynamite with a gun or a girl. Together, they blast all screen traditions in This Gun for Hire, drama-packed story of Philip Raven, whose search for vengeance on the man who betrayed him puts 100 policemen on his trail and forces him to hide behind a girl.
Watch it, Copper.
It's Raven. Do what he says.
You stay where you are.
There's a dragnet out for you, Raven. It won't do any good to hurt her, so use your head.
You better stay put. Who trusts anybody?
You couldn't very well complain to the police, could you?
I'm my own police.
What could you do?
First, I'd find out who you're stooging for. And I'd give him what I gave Baker.
Don't I? I can't stand violence.
Then I'd whittle off a little of that blubber.
You still want that stuff from Gates?
Of course I do.
Help me out of here and I'll get it for you. What was that hot air last night? That flag waver. Okay, I'll shoot it out with him and I hope your copper gets the first slug.
I had seen The Glass Key. Mm-hmm. And I had seen, why am I blanking on the other movie? Blue Dahlia?
Yeah, that's the other big one. Although Blake and Ladd did make more films kind of on the
right.
noir cusp.
But there's but like there's three, right? There's a holy trinity of Alan Ladd and Veronica Lake noirs. And This Gun for Hire has been on my shelf for as long as I can remember. I bought it when the DVD came out. I don't even know. 20 years, maybe? Who knows?
I think we have the same DVD.
It's probably traveled with me to three different apartments. So This Gun for Hire, 1942, is based on the 1936 Graham Greene novel, published under the same name in the U.S., but as A Gun for Sale in the U.K. It's a deceptively complex film noir that kind of encroaches into an espionage scenario at one point. So in wartime San Francisco, a hitman kills a chemist, I believe he's a chemist, and steals a formula that's just on a piece of paper. Seems very low tech, but it's just like, it's this piece of paper that becomes the red herring, not the MacGuffin, yes. Red herring. It could be a red herring. I don't know. MacGuffin. For the rest of the movie, the hitman is named Philip Raven, played by Alan Ladd. Raven is double-crossed by his employee who hired him to take it, who is a kind of a industrialist named Willard Gates. He runs Nitro Chemical, so he pays him with marked bills and reports him to the police so that he can eliminate all the loose ends for his dirty dealings. Well, Alan Ladd gets wind of the setup and vows to extract a pound of flesh from his employer.
See, the thing I love about that summary is that you've really, gotten to the bones of the plot and, you know, kind of what the motivation is. But you haven't even mentioned Veronica Lake, which goes to show the way in which she is kind of incidental to the plot, but emotionally the centerpiece of the film.
Right.
You know, it's just a great...
It's such a difficult film to put into words. Like, there's the plot, and then there's the way it unfolds, which feels entirely different.
Absolutely.
Because we meet Ellen Graham, a nightclub singer and singing sleight of hand magician.
What a career. It's a living, I guess.
Played by Veronica Lake, and she is hired by that terrible business person who is trying to kill Alan Ladd to be a singer in his nightclub because he's apparently into black market chemical formulas and owning a nightclub, which is something that these noir villains had a tendency to do. They had their villainy, but they also had a highly respectable nightclub on the side. This is where it gets a bit twisty for the viewers at home who haven't seen This Gun for Hire. She gets roped into some sort of clandestine operation where she's supposed to spy on her supposedly dirty boss's operation for the government. And in returning to L.A., she just happens to be on the same train and sit next to Alan Ladd's hitman. She falls asleep on his shoulder. They have not discussed their sort of parallel involvement in this crime. And the bad guy thinks that they must have talked all about their situation and are now conspiring against him.
Don't you just hate it when you get seated next to like a hitman on Amtrak and suddenly you get embroiled in, you know, some kind of spy, you know, revenge plot? That happens to me a lot, and it's really awkward.
I know. That's why I had to stop taking public transportation.
You know, it's cheap, but, you know, there's the noir angles that you got to consider.
I mean, the T in Boston was just full of incidents just like that. The stretch between Harvard Square and Kendall was just full of potential espionage.
Every stop, there's a guy in a trench coat comes in, clearly with a gun under his coat. Right. You know, it's terrible.
It's not that they were physicists working at MIT. They really were film noir villains. I think that sufficiently summarizes why this movie is just so packed with stuff. Mm-hmm. Beyond that, you just need to know that it's super slick and stylish and oozes sex appeal because you've got Alan Ladd and Veronica Lake in absolute pristine form of humanity on screen. 1942 Veronica Lake and Alan Ladd. And Alan Ladd was fourth billed on this movie. I mean, this is before he was even a thing, and it was this movie, and you watch him, you can see exactly why this movie skyrocketed into stardom.
Oh, totally. And, you know, it's interesting to me because Frank Tuttle, you know, we mentioned him on Does Gun for Hire, we mentioned him on Suspense, you know, really an underrated director, I think, when you look at his film record. And interestingly enough, Louise Brooks, who worked with him in the 20s, she said that he was a real gifted director at getting non-actors like her to do what they needed to do for the camera. Well, I kind of contest that she was a non-actor because I think she was a great actor, but I think there's something
people
to
told
that.
Her she was a non-actor. She was just being self-effacing. I thought she was brilliant, but
I agree absolutely. But he directed her in a film called Love Him and Leave Him, and it was early in her film career, so maybe that's why she felt that he knew what to do with her as a non-actor, you know, at that point, as someone who wasn't totally understand, you know, that he knew how to get her to do what she needed to do for the camera. And I think it's interesting that, you know, he becomes a star maker a little bit for Alan Ladd in the sense that he, you know, Alan Ladd gives this incendiary performance. So I wonder if it was something about Tuttle, maybe, that he knew how to bring this intensity out of Alan Ladd, you know, in this film that made him absolutely a star. And, you know, maybe a little bit for Veronica Lake, too, who I, again, another one who I think is a great actress, but who got a bit of a reputation for being difficult and, you know, not knowing what to do for directors who kind of looked down on her. Maybe he had enough humility that he kind of knew how to coach actors and sort of just kind of saying, you know, ah, you know what to do. I don't really care. I mean, I'm not sure exactly what his method was as a director, but he did have, I think, a gift for sort of giving actors the direction they needed, but not too much that it made them nervous and unable to create. So Frank Tuttle, kind of a guy.
He's someone I've never read much about him. I mean, I know his work, but I mean, I've never really read a piece on the man to know more of what he was like.
Yeah, it's something that I'd like to look more into. And another story I will tell about This Gun for Hire, and this is one from Veronica Lake's autobiography. Do you know the story about her first screen kiss, as she said?
I don't remember it, but I've read the book, so. Deep in my subconscious, it's in there.
Well, for This Gun for Hire, she talks about how this was her first, you know, ballyhooed screen kiss. And, you know, it was the scene where she's kissing the cop who's her boyfriend. She does not kiss Alan Ladd except on the cheek in this film. So that's an interesting thing to note. But supposedly, you know, it's embarrassing enough to have to film a kiss scene, you know, you have to do it a couple of times, and you know, it's this intimate thing that you got to do for the cameras with the crews there and all this stuff. And in her case, it was even worse because it was at a carnival scene, you know, it was at a train station right after they've been in a carnival. So the set was just loaded with extras, and they're all sitting around to get this big gander of, let's see what Veronica Lake's first screen kiss was. And, you know, they had to do it a couple of times, and she just describes it as this unbearably awkward experience. So I always feel a little twinge of sympathy for poor Veronica Lake in that kissing scene, but her kiss with Alan Ladd is lovely, where she kisses him on the cheek. And I think something that I love about this Gun for Hire is that in noir, and I know we've talked a little bit about the way film noir is able to convey a lot without showing anything, but I mean, there really are a lot of noir couples who really never get very far physically. I mean, in the sense that it's not even implied, or it's frustrated, or it never gets anywhere. And I feel like this Gun for Hire is an example of that, but it's maybe the purest example of it, that the connection between them is so almost spiritual. It's like the sense of like these two lonely souls finding each other. It's a really beautiful film. Like, you know, we can talk about all the plot dynamics, but you know, it just, something clicks between these two, and there's this tenderness there. You know, I wrote a little bit about the tenderness of noir in a recent post, because I know people think noir is all hard-boiled and cynical and mean, and you know, it's all that. I'm not going to make the case that it's not, but I think part of the reason why it does work is that there are these moments of delicacy and tenderness that kind of make the harshness of the world seem all the more spiky and awful, and yet there's something miraculous that this connection can exist even in this, you know, dirty, unfragrant world, to steal from Raymond Chandler a little bit there.
Yeah, the Alan Ladd and Veronica Lake really are an ideal pair, and you can, their chemistry is all over the place, and they both kind of operate in the same frequency. They're both cold and mysterious in this movie, and something that I mean that you pick up on it immediately. And I am an absolute devotee of Melville. So watching this and seeing what is clearly inspiration for the look of Le Samurai was sort of a revelation to me. Alan Ladd in the trench coat the entire time, the hat. You can even see how it seeps into Alain Delon's performance in Le Samurai.
Oh, yeah.
Putting pieces of cinema together, like the stepping stones and the building blocks to get, when you finally see how it builds to one of your absolute favorite movies, it's sort of a cathartic experience. And it even got a positive review from the notoriously crabby Bosley Crowther.
That is a miracle.
It's one of the first times I have ever seen a positive remark about a movie I've talked about on Cinema Shame. Because I often look specifically for the Bosley Crowther review to see if he ever said anything positive. Good news, he did. He said about Alan Ladd, "Mr. Ladd is the buster. He is really an actor to watch. After this stinging performance, he has something to live up to or live down."
Whew, yeah, I don't think praise comes much higher from him. Wow, he must have seen it on a good day.
And I also have a little thing I found from John Houseman, who wrote that Ladd played a professional killer with a poignant and desolate ferocity that made him unique for a time among male heroes of his day.
Yeah.
Which I thought was interesting, because I don't necessarily think of Alan Ladd in that light. Not like this. So I think that it's worthwhile to see that he was such an immediate success with this particular movie.
Yes, absolutely. I feel like his status as a tough guy has really kind of waned over the years. Where he, you know, he just doesn't rate quite as much as, you know, Bogart or Cagney, or even some of these guys who came up in the 40s, like, you know, Lawrence Tierney or Robert Mitchum or Dana Andrews. You know, he just doesn't get talked about in the same kind of way. But he was a very good actor, and he really did have this kind of cold intensity that makes him really fascinating to watch when he's on his A game. I do think, you know, this Gun for Hire, it's such a meteoric performance that it's hard, you know, sort of like Bosley Crowther says, you know, it's how do you live up or live down to this? You know, it's kind of like, you know, you just shot up with this great performance. But I mean, he's good in a lot of films that I've seen. You know, we know Glass Key and Blue Dahlia. For the first time this year, I also watched a film called Calcutta, which was not a great film, but he's quite good in it. You know, he's also a very good Gatsby. And I feel like part of the reason why his status has sort of waned is the fact that the films he made were mostly at Paramount. And, you know, outside of the big ones that got the big film noir DVD releases 20 years ago and have been re-released since, they haven't gotten a lot of traction. I know Kino Lorber released a couple of his Paramount noir films, but they just, I think the lack of availability of them has sort of kept him a little bit more in the shadows, as it were.
That's a very good point.
Yeah, I mean, so much when we're talking about film and whose status makes it, who becomes an icon. I mean, outside of the really top tier icons who everybody knows because, you know, they're like Coca-Cola, I think that, you know, just film availability shapes this a lot. The Paramount films, Universal films, they're just not going to turn up on TCM with the same kind of frequency. They're not going to have the same kind of cachet, which is a shame.
Paramount is notorious for being the tight-fisted when it comes to releasing their catalog titles.
Mm-hmm.
Really is. It's so frustrating to look on. Like, I keep a list of, it used to be like 100 movies that I wanted to see on Blu-ray, and half of them are Paramount titles.
Mm-hmm.
And probably two-thirds of those have never even been released. Like, it's just insane how Paramount continues. I mean, they reissue their A titles over and over and over again, but they never dig into those deep cuts. And they've started to do a little bit more, but they're still just barely scratching the surface.
Yeah, I've been hopeful. It's given me some hope to see Kino Lorber releasing an increasingly large amount of Paramount titles and Universal titles. So I'm hoping to see that. I really got my fingers crossed that there will be more coming along the way. But even so, you know, the damage is done. While other films have been circulating and gaining traction, you know, these ones have kind of been out of the public eye, and it's a bummer.
Yeah, I mean, I think the time is almost gone now because the film community that came up with DVDs and Blu-rays is, you know, it's they've kind of had their day. The market's not expanding, so if they weren't out and available, I don't know that there's really a way to fix that at this point, because our viewing habits and our available avenues for watching these movies have become so fractured. We'll notice, we'll appreciate it, but like you said, it's never going to make that ground up.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that's why it's so important that, you know, people like us do what we do. I mean, that's kind of what I just try to see myself as, is someone who is just out there beating the drum, cheerleading for these films. You know, yeah. I'm not here to teach people about these films oftentimes, as just I'm here to tell people that these films exist and they're great, that they're going to add something to your life, that if you like XYZ, you're going to love XYZ, you know, ZYX, you know, this film you've never heard of. You know, it's very much like these other films, and kind of I think that's why we're doing what we're doing, is putting these films in dialogue in a way that will hopefully intrigue some people to, you know, get a little deeper into their viewing, or even if they're already very deep into their viewing, but this one was a blind spot for them. You know, your whole premise of Cinema Shame, I think, is very, very valid here, in sort of incentivizing people through their shame to explore new territory and maybe pick up some of these films that when you were going on a film noir binge 10 years ago, you missed because they were really hard to see. And I will also just put in a little bit of a shout out here for OK.ru, which is the place where I have seen so many older films. I wouldn't do that unless I had to. You know, I want to buy it. I want to give my cold, hard-earned cash to DVD companies. You know, I'm a big believer in physical media. But I mean, some of these films are just, they're not going to be there for a very long time. And it's really frustrating. I mean, I have people all the time say, is there a way to watch this? And I really don't, you know, I kind of can't legally tell them. But, you know, if you just go to Google and you search it and you go to the videos tab of Google search, like, you might see something that you did not expect to see there. And I know that's kind of how I found some of these films that, for whatever reason, you know, for whatever legal hang up or lack of inclination on the part of the studio, have been consigned to oblivion, at least, you know, probably for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, if these companies aren't releasing their movies, you got to do what you got to do. I have no qualms with telling people where to find a movie. The only way that it can be seen, and you know, you want to increase the profile by 10 people, maybe those 10 people become 100, and maybe eventually you've got a market for it.
Exactly, yeah.
Thank you.
what do you have for us in the international flavor?
So this was really hard to pick, actually, because I just was attending, virtually attending, the Noir City Online Festival, which was focused on international noir. And, you know, I've seen a lot of films. I've, you know, dipped probably more into kind of the big classics of French film noir, not as much the deep cuts. But, you know, I've seen a lot of Japanese noir. But I have not seen the vast majority of the films that were shown as part of this festival. It was just a really adventurous selection, I thought. I really enjoyed all the films I watched, including some of the ones I approached with trepidation. So it was great. But one that I really enjoyed the most, the one that I just kind of wanted to move into, the one where I wanted to pull up a chair and say, what are you eating, was Rozsa, which was a French film noir starring Jean Gabin, directed by Henri Ducoing.
Que personne ne bouge. Restez en place. A qui appartient la drogue? D'où arrive l'opium? Des Balkans, hein?
J'aime pas qu'on me bouscule. Je rends pas aux menaces, moi. Jamais.
T'es pas breton pour rien. Ouais.
And the title, the full French title, Rozsa sur le schnuff, means like the raid on drugs or the raid on the junkies. You know, it's one of these French slangy titles. And what I loved about this film, I'm not really too into films that are like, we explore the workings of the underworld as much as I'm more about like the twisted romance noir. But what I loved about Rozsa was that Jean Gabin, he didn't seem too into the inner workings of the underworld either. He did not seem very like, what I loved about it is that he has just such an earthy, grounded, mellow vibe in this later phase of his career. So he's supposed to be leading this drug ring in Paris, you know, after having gotten all this experience with rackets in America. But like, he's just a dude who seems way more interested in running his little restaurant as a front, in eating well, in canoodling with his gorgeous 20-something sweetie pie. He just, like, the sensuality of this character and just kind of the lack of desire, like, oh man, do I have to go intimidate a pusher today? Do I have to go meet a supplier? Like, I just want to hang here. Like, I love that energy, this not just world weary period. You know, it was just a really interesting vibe from him that he, I mean, kind of almost like John Wayne, you know, who things happen around and he kind of masters the events. It's almost a little bit what Jean Gabin had going on here, and that he's this guy that things happen around and he kind of puts out fires and keeps them under control. And it's just, it was this film that felt kind of almost like a hangout movie in some ways. I really just enjoyed this movie about Jean Gabin as an extremely mellow drug kingpin, and his whole attitude of, you had one job to do, or you're really going to pull me away from my, you know, plate of delicious cutlets, so I have to go clean up your messes, you idiots. And, you know, there's all these kind of great little colorful sub-characters and rackets, like this one woman pusher who runs this club where everybody is dancing like zombies, and like the cigarette girls are dispensing the drugs and taking it in the bathroom, this eerie ambiance, and she finally snaps and screams at everybody, take your drugs and die. I mean, it's just it's full of all these odd little vignettes. There's actually a pair of gay gangsters. It was making me think of the big combo, one of whom is very worried that Jean Gabin is going to steal his very pretty boyfriend. And so that was kind of a little bit of it was more explicit than it would have been in any American film, I think, where the woman drug dealer says, oh, don't worry, he's not interested in your guy. You know, don't be jealous. So this is kind of a weird little thing there. It has a bit of a disappointing ending, but in a way, you, given the way I came to feel about the characters, I was not as disappointed as I probably should have been, given how much the ending kind of undercuts everything that came before it. But it was a really enjoyable film to hang out with and to be around, especially in quarantine, where you just want to go out and go to restaurants and walk through the streets and imbibe life. This film really gave me that fix that I was looking for, which is appropriate for a film about the drug traffic.
Yeah, I am not familiar with that one, but it is now on the list.
Oh, it's fun. I think you'd like it.
So I will have a disclaimer in that both of my films are French. And I just want you to pronounce all of the names for me. So, again, I'm continuing with my theme of movies that I should have watched by now, because that's pretty much the way I operate. This movie was actually on my beginning of year shame list that I write before I embark on a year of movie watching. It is a movie that was recommended to me by Stephanie Crawford. Last year, I went into the Barnes & Noble Criterion sale and I tweeted out, tell me your, just give me a pick for a movie I haven't seen and I'll buy it. And she told me to pick up Elevator to the Gallows, and I said yes, obviously, because I knew about the Miles Davis score, but I'd never watched the movie.
I was just going to say, it's funny you mentioned that, because this is a film I saw for the first time this year as well. It had long been on my list and I hadn't gotten around to it.
It's pretty much just, sometimes you watch a movie and it's just the right wavelength. Like everything about it. And I have a certain affection for novels and fiction writing that feels like improvisation. So I'm thinking about specifically books like Gravity's Rainbow, Thomas Pynchon. Like the way that he writes is the way I think a jazz improvisation sounds on the page. It's like his writing is something that you cannot search for meaning. You cannot pick apart specific moments and look for answers. You have to let the book and, you know, when movies find this wavelength, you have to let it wash over you and then think about it after the fact. So watching Elevator to the Gallows, it's certainly aided by Miles Davis and his improvisational score. I'll touch on that in just a second. And the way that that influences this movie. But Elevator to the Gallows is just such a beautifully shot, black and white exercise in total control over what it feels like for this visual improvisation of the film language. It doesn't adhere to any particular guideline with the way the narrative unfolds. You're introduced to characters. The main character disappears for an entire middle portion of the movie, and that's not the way films are made, we're told, right? Like, you stick with your main character, they come in and out of the narrative, you can leave them, but they are the focus. So when this movie departs from our main character, who we're told our main character, and goes off on this tangent, you know, part of your brain that wants movies to be a certain way could certainly stand up and object and say, that's not the way you do this movie. Right. But if you just let it happen and you don't let those objections get in the way of your ability to experience the movie, this, I think it can affect you in different and perhaps more unusual ways. Jean Moreau and Maurice is it Ronet?
How's it spelled?
R-O-N-E-T is the actor's name. I don't know him from anything else.
Ronet.
They're adulterous lovers who've plotted to kill her husband, who is a wealthy businessman who seems to have some ties to supplying the industrial war machine. He's an ex-soldier of some variety. So the murder actually takes place in the opening few minutes of the film, but as Julian, the character Julian Tavernier, exits the building, he recognizes that he's left this grappling hook attached to the side of the building, which is kind of incriminating when he tries to make it set up as a suicide. So he goes back into the building, gets in the elevator, and the elevator operator, he seems like more of a like a kind of all-around handy guy of the building, turns off the power, and the elevator stops midway up to the floor. So our main character, the person who was set up as the main character, is now stuck inside an elevator within the first 15 minutes of the film. So as he runs back into the building, he just happens to leave his car parked out front, keys in the ignition, and this, I don't know, he's a like a teenage malcontent and his flower shop girlfriend, I guess we can call them, take the car and go on a joyride where they eventually kind of hunker down at this odd futuristic motel that's like if Howard Johnson thought it was really fancy. It's such an unusual setting. I had to question whether that was an actual thing or not because it's just inserted in this film matter-of-factly. And they check in under the name Julien Tavernier. And then we're back in Paris again, and the Jean Moreau character is wandering the streets of Paris, checking cafes, wandering around to his old haunts. She doesn't know if he's arrested, disappeared, decided not to perform this murder of her husband. So she wanders and walks, and watching Jean Moreau walk is poetry.
It really is.
That's all she does. And you can see how some of these moments, especially as she's wandering Paris, contribute to the French New Wave, which hadn't quite reached its peak yet. This is certainly like late gestation French New Wave. And the story is told in these three distinct parts that don't really intersect except at the very beginning and the very end. And they're not woven logically together. There seems to be, like I said, there's very little concern that you've left your main character for 30 minutes. But this kind of freewheeling sense that we're just kind of experiencing the film is totally fed by this Miles Davis score. And I'm not going to get super nerdy about jazz right now. I had to write down what I was going to say because I didn't want to get too excited about it. But I was familiar with this score. I knew it. I'd listened to it. And I'm a big Miles Davis fan. So seeing how it actually played in the film was sort of a revelation. The score itself is an early example of his sort of experiments in modal jazz composition, which is, again, not getting too far down the rabbit hole. It's an improvisational style of music that de-emphasizes chords and foregrounds the shifting experimental improvisational motifs, atonal and chromatic melodies. So, you know, for the sake of brevity, we'll just say that this score is the birth of the cool. Like, this is the process by which he developed Kind of Blue, which came out less than 2 years after this. And as a score, too, we've already talked about the poetry of Jean Moreau just walking. You've added this Miles Davis score, and honestly, if it was nothing more than her wandering Paris to Miles Davis, I would have been content.
Same. Yeah, you know, something, it's funny you say that, because for me that was the most involving, you know, spellbinding part of the film, just this long walk around the streets at night. And it made me think about how many of the the noir sequences or the noir shots that linger in my mind are women walking around at night. You know, Mildred Pierce on the pier at the beginning, Helen Brent, you know, the Claire Trevor character, looking out at the Bay Bridge and smoking before meeting the private eye in Born to Kill. When Anne Baxter's character is walking the streets at night in The Blue Dahlia, or the famous ending sequence, you know, the suspense sequence in The Seventh Victim. You know, so much of this is women walking around at night. But in these films, because they are plot-driven, character-driven, you know, tight Hollywood films, you don't get much of that. That's, you know, that's like a little tidbit that just sort of you kind of wish you could linger with that mood. But that is the mood. That is the noir right there. You know, and it's kind of interesting that what Elevator to the Gallows did was say, well, let's just do the mood. You know, the plot is non-essential, you know, sort of like you're saying, it's, you know, the spirit of improvisation, the spirit of just kind of being and going with the flow, or seeming to, because obviously it's like a great feeling, deal of discipline goes in.
Feeling the movie as it unfolds, like it, Maul doesn't seem to have, I mean, I'm sure it's meticulously planned, right? But you feel like he's just going with it. Like, I want to be here for a while. I want to watch her walk into this cafe and talk to these people, and then she's going to walk out of the cafe. And then maybe we'll go back to these misfit teenagers for 30 minutes as they just have, you know, culture wars with this older couple. And then, oh, we'll go back to the guy in the elevator. Like, there doesn't seem to be a logical narrative sequencing.
Yeah, you know, it's one of the articles that really opened my mind to what it is that was different about European art cinema from the movies that I grew up with, the classic movies I knew. The black and white movies I watched that were European were so different from American ones. That is to say, you know, the ones that were released through the Criterion Channel, the Criterion Collection, you know, movies like Elevator to the Gallows, or, you know, like Fellini films, or, you know, New Wave films, like what was different about them? And it was I think it was a Boardwell article I read in college where he talked about the looseness of association in European art cinema. That's not to say that they're not still character driven on some level. They are, but the plots are dilated, you know, in the service of psychological states and, you know, what the internet would call vibes. You know, we're just invited right. to vibe with them. You know, well, there's a plot, there's some cause and effect here, but it's just so much more about just hanging out with these ideas and these moods and the sense that it is being improvised, even though, you know, as you say, there's a mastermind behind it. There's a structure behind it. It is deceptively, you know, controlled, even as it seems loose and flowy.
Talking about the sense or the feeling, and these characters are not deep. They've been given no particular nuance. They really are acting as pawns in a kind of ill-fated chess game. They're moved around to move the narrative forward. Like you said, is mood and tone, and it has very little to do with characters making specific choices within the film. I mean, obviously there's one specific choice that causes a chain reaction. I can't really talk about that without giving the whole second half of the film. The best thing that I could come up with was that Elevator to the Gallows is about stasis. The main character, or Julien Duvivier, is stuck in an elevator. Jean Moreau is trapped in a loveless romance. And our freewheeling teenagers have been caught in a trap of their own design because of their, it's like naivete, it's this
alienation, their
nihilism,
their
right? Like there's not a real sense that their actions have repercussions, and they've created their jail, their prison. So that's this feeling that this film invokes.
Although, you know, the thing that interests me about it is that it is everything you say. It is poetic. It is stasis. It is, you know, a kind of defiance against our human need to see cause and effect in things, to want characters to master their destiny, and so they just kind of go with the flow. I mean, there's very few choices, and yet, you know, you get the sense that all of the choices have kind of been made before this film. Mm-hmm. You know, this is all aftermath, no kind of, you know, leading up to it, no climax, just all sort of afterwards. And yet it is a film that is so suffused with noir tropes, with, you know, it is so recognizably noir just without the plot elements. And mm-hmm. although I will say it is also one of the great, oh no, I screwed up noirs.
Yeah.
Or crime films. I mean, there really is a kind of a little subset. I mean, obviously a lot of heist films kind of fall into this, but, you know, one that comes to my mind right off the top of my head is Dial M for Murder, which is, you know, a film that is excruciatingly plot driven and, you know, tight as a drum. In some ways the absolute antithesis of this film, and yet it's kind of a similar, on paper they're the same, they're about plan B's, you know. Mm-hmm. They're about someone whose entire plan just collapses and now they have to improvise something different. And, you know, it's kind of interesting the way in which this sort of idea of coming up with a plan B or rebounding from something that got screwed up, the plan went wrong, can take these extremely, you know, diametrically opposed forms, one that is super controlled and tight and every minute feels, you know, managed, versus something like this that is like a tone poem in response to that.
And they said the noir tropes, there's a couple moments of shocking violence that kind of, one in particular, you can feel it building and you're even kind of surprised when it happens. And then there's a kind of a undercurrent of absurdist black comedy that often kind of creeps in into the film in interesting ways. I mentioned the weird motel, which is it almost feels like Monsieur Hulot should show up at some point and wander through the set. There's also some they're clearly meant to be humorous, the relationship between the different investigators that are on this case. They share a few moments that are just, that had me actually laughing out loud at the subtle glances between the two, and the way the one just thinks he's going to bully his way to an answer, and he keeps berating people when they clearly don't have any clue what he wants to know.
Again, such a noir staple of the comic relief of the, like, you know, the two detectives with the opposing styles, or kind of the detective who's a little eccentric and going rogue, you know, kind of, it's kind of the fascinating thing to me about the film is the way in which it accomplishes this completely different melodic, you know, this improvised form, this loose form, and yet it still does manage to pay tribute to so many of the things that we expect from a noir.
Mm-hmm.
Without feeling, you know, like it's over contrived, without feeling like it's over plotted or even plotted at all in some points.
It's my experience with Louis Malle too is interesting. You know, I kind of work backwards with him. I've seen quite a few of his films, and I really began with, you know, Vanya on 42nd Street and My Dinner with Andre, the Wallace Shawn and Andre Gregory collaborations, and Damage with Jeremy Irons, like his 90s mm-hmm. films I watched because they were available, and some of them I studied in film school, and like I'd never really had a sense of Louis Malle as a filmmaker. I never, like, there's very little through line through his films, and it's interesting to look back and see how many of his movies I'd actually seen without knowing they were Louis Malle films.
I have to think about that. Yeah,
he's kind of a filmmaker of anomalies. He finishes something and he's like, I'm done with that, and he reacts and moves on to something else. I couldn't help but think about how he must have driven Truffaut mad by just never following a film up with anything that resembles it. And this kind of came to a head because I'm watching Elevator to the Gallows, and, you know, I'd read about it and knew specifically that it was a Louis Malle film. So I watched it and for the first time thought of it as a Louis Malle film. I'm like, this isn't a Louis Malle film either. Like, what? So, like, part of me, the part of me that that does adhere to the school of Truffaut, like, wants to put him in a box. Like, mm-hmm. I want to understand who he was as a filmmaker. And the other part is, like, that's who he is. Like, the reaction to and the anomalous films, that maybe that's Louis Malle. But that was just a different thing that popped into my head as I started thinking about my notes for this movie.
Hmm.
And the Robert Bresson influence is super visible here, and the two of them work together, and you can tell that Bresson clearly influenced him in the direction of Elevator to the Gallows.
Yeah, a lot of food for thought on Louis Malle, whose career I really haven't explored greatly beyond some of the big highlights, maybe for a future Cinema Shame
episode.
Just
because it's like we're never given like a course in Louis Malle, because it feels like there isn't one to have, which is kind of interesting, because I mean I studied Louis Malle films, but I never studied his career in the same way I did other contemporaries of his.
Yeah, he just really doesn't fit that paradigm, does he?
No. I think that's all my rambling notes for Elevator to the Gallows, which I hope somehow mirrored your future experience with the film, in that it is rambling and slightly incoherent. But yeah, now on to yours, I suppose.
I'm glad that you brought up Elevator to the Gallows, because it's a film that certain sequences really stayed with me, but it was a film that on the whole I wouldn't totally say I enjoyed or was kind of like going to rush to see again, although it definitely kind of resonated with me and gave me a lot of food for thought. But after having this conversation, I think I might be due for a revisit. It seems like the kind of film that would improve on additional viewings, like, you know, that you would, your appreciation for it would deepen, rather than, you know, it's a film that, as you say, even though the characters feel sometimes maybe not shallow but not ultra developed, there's still kind of, there's a deepness to its surface, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes the films that are all surface are deeper than the films that claim to be deep, you know, that try to be deep. And you know, it's actually kind of a good segue into my second foreign noir film, and that is Pale Flower. You know, another film that's sort of about stasis and about trying to escape stasis, about these nocturnal ramblings that don't exactly have a goal, where people's relationships are not really defined. So this is a Japanese noir directed by, and I hope I'm going to say this correctly, Masahiro Shinoda. And it's about a Yakuza who's been released from prison for killing a man, and he's disgusted with humanity. He doesn't see the people around him as fully people. You know, we get the cynical, nihilistic intro voiceover for him as he looks around the pathetic individuals all around him. And the only thing that seems to make him feel alive is going to these little gambling dens where he plays this hypnotic Japanese card game involving all these cards with flowers on them. And the rules, Imogen Smith did an intro for this for the Noir City, and as she explained, you don't need to know the rules of this game to kind of be mesmerized by it. And that is absolutely true. You don't need to know a thing about Japanese games of chance in order to enjoy this film. So don't worry about that right there. Just like you don't need to understand the rules of Baccarat to understand any, you know, casino film ever made, I would say.
I've given up.
So I mean, some of these games, I'm just, you know, I'm just there for the tuxedos, frankly. But in this case, you're just there for, you know, the sounds of the cards and the motion and the play of glances between all these individuals. Because in his misspent nights and afternoons in these gambling dens, he happens across this mysterious woman who is clearly, this is not her milieu. She is not a gangster moll. She seems fresh and well-born, but yet she has this intense desire, apparently, to dive into the depths of depravity, to just see everything there is to see, to experience, you know, every adrenaline rush she can. And that's why she goes to these gambling dens, and she forms a partnership with him and asks him to get her to take her to a higher stakes gambling den. They go there together. And it really, for me, is one of these twisted love stories between two people who seem to bring out the worst in each other. You know, it is kind of almost a avant-garde, or you know, more loose and tonal version of the kinds of relationships we see in movies like Gun Crazy or Out of the Past or Born to Kill. It belongs in that canon of noir twisted love stories. You know, it's one of the great movies in that little subgenre there. I mean, it might be a stretch to call it a romance, and yet it is unquestionably, to me at least, a love story, you know, of just these two people who are match each other in all these ways. And it seems like a film that is probably more influential than it's given credit for. I mean, I know I'd heard it spoken of, but I mean, this ending sequence that is both extremely violent and yet tremendously lyrical, almost like a state of grace, you know, in which the hero is forever. It's almost like a ceremonial marriage to this woman with whom he's obsessed and who kind of has driven him to do ever more dangerous things. It's one of these scenes that you see echoes of it in every lyrically directed killing in every film that has been made since then. I mean, it's just a really extraordinary film, set in the streets at night, and it just has kind of like Elevator to Gallows. So more than anything, it is a mood piece. Not a lot really happens until all of a sudden, wow, a lot just happened there. You know,
Japanese are very good at that type of pacing. I've noticed they do really set a mood, and then there is a point of catharsis where in the attention or the simmering romance or whatever has been building comes out. And I've become more appreciative of that style the more Japanese films that I've watched, you know, outside of the samurai films, because that's that for a long time that was my primary exposure.
Have you seen this one, Pale Flower?
I have not, and I do know it's a Criterion release.
You know, it's one of these films where I know I had seen other people tweet about it, and it always just sounded like something I would like, you know, a doomed romance, an obsessive love story around gambling in the underworld of Yokohama. It just sounded like something that would be right in my, you know, the range of what I'd like to watch. But yeah, I think it's funny when you think a film is going to be right for you, in some cases it almost makes you more hesitant to approach it because you want to know you have that film that you want to see. You know, mm-hmm. you don't want to have that feeling that you've seen every film that is on your radar that you kind of think you'd like. And I think also it's a little bit of a worry that you're not going to like it as much as you think you will. You know, if you kind of preserve this thought of, oh, there's this film that I'm going to like and I'm going to save that someday for when I want to see it. So that was a little bit like me with Pale Flower. The stills I had seen of it just looked gorgeous. And it really, I'm pleased to say that it every bit lived up to what I was hoping it would be and more. It really stayed with me. I was especially taken with the lead actor. I hope I'm saying this correctly, Ryo Ikebe, who was kind of going through a phase of being a little bit of a has-been at that point. And that's why he was chosen for this role. But he has, he has a really a kind of a vibe that reminds me a lot of Robert Mitchum in Out of the Past, actually. He almost strikes me as like a Japanese Robert Mitchum. I mean, you know, he has obviously his own qualities and you know, performance. But that's kind of like the equivalent I could think of an American cinema. He has this sort of sense of world weariness, of disillusionment that only makes him more cool and fascinating. So it was just a really a good performance, and a performance that is so focused on the fascinating female figure as she flits through his life and messes things up in some ways for him. It was really interesting to me how well his film really anchored that, how much his performance anchored that film, and how wonderful it was. It was just a lot to think about in a film that I have thought a lot about since I've seen it. You know, I loved it while I was watching it, and it has, you know, little snippets from it have popped in my head ever since.
That is a good sign. No matter how much you enjoy a film at its first glance, the ones that that linger in your brain. The Elevator to the Gallows had the same situation with me, in that I liked it when I watched it, but it was the way that it stuck with me and how I wanted to go back and revisit specific moments because they were now burned into a part of my brain. My next selection has been already mentioned, and you were indirectly involved in my watching it because you apparently told Will McKinley about it, and Will McKinley told me to watch it. And I am, of course, referring to Panique from 1946.
Tu connaissais pas d'ennemis.
C'est le crime d'un poitou ou le crime d'un sadique.
Tu penses bien qu'ils ont compris que dans l'affaire des vols, je m'étais accusé pour un autre.
Alors il faut qu'on passe. By Julien Duvivier. My experience with Duvivier is painfully limited.
Well, you know, I will say that that's not totally a reflection on you, because a lot of his films are not easy to see. I mean, they're not as commonly released. I mean, I know a couple of them have been released on Criterion Collection or some of these kind of more artistic, you know, art house labels, repertory labels, but they're not hugely circulated. Like, I mean, you know, after Panique, I kind of had a similar desire to see more of his films, and you know, I was able on my trusty OKRU to find some more, but they haven't all gotten the attention or the releases they've deserved. I know one that I don't think is, I think still is not on DVD, is an American made film, a film he made here called Lydia, which is just fantastic. It's one of Merle Oberon's best performances, made the same year as Sizz and Kane, and it's very similar to Kane in this flashback structure and this multiple realities being recalled, except it's focused on a woman and her romantic adventures, disappointments, hopes and dreams, and kind of the subjectivity of memory and the regrets of old age. I mean, it's got a lot of overlaps with Citizen Kane, and yet, you know, we all know Citizen Kane, and how mm-hmm. few people have know Lydia. So he is, I think, a little bit of an untapped director, again, in part because of the lack of availability of films, I think, has influenced him not having a huge, having the place that probably he does deserve. I mean, wasn't it, I think it was Jean Renoir or something who said that his name should be writ large on the temple of cinema or something mm-hmm. like that. I mean, when, you know, how much
I remember reading something like that as well from Renoir. Mm-hmm. So Panique is, it's set in post-war France, and it's the first film Duvivier made upon his return from self-exile in Hollywood during World War II, and he received quite a bit of heat from his contemporaries for abandoning France during the war, which certainly couldn't have fueled this narrative whatsoever. So Alice, character Alice, Vivienne Romance, has just been released from prison after taking the heat for her boyfriend's robbery. She arrives in a small French town the day after a prostitute is found murdered. She pretends to meet her boyfriend Alfred, played by Paul Bernard, for the first time that day. All the while, there is an eccentric and antisocial misanthrope called Monsieur Here. Yeah, Here, is it Here? I think so,
yeah.
Michelle Simon, who has taken a liking to her and has some information that he's not particularly ready to give away, that she should stay away from Alfred and should inquire further about the poor prostitute's murder. When the boyfriend finds out about this little recommendation, he concocts a scheme to turn the locals against Monsieur Here, and suggests that maybe he's not just an eccentric, maybe he's actually the murderer. The seeds for this conclusion have already been planted, because the character of Monsieur here is arrogant, and he cuts through the pretensions of his peers with rapier-like barbs that only reinforces intellectual superiority over them. He walks into the butcher and complains that his meat is not bloody enough and his cheese isn't runny enough. He's always annoying shopkeepers with his, I called it, his unwavering specificity. He refuses to make small talk because it's all just a big waste of time. I don't know who can't relate to that.
And, we are all Monsieur here these days.
I know. It feels so
real. He just
real.
Missed his time. He just missed his era. If he'd been born today, maybe he would have stood a chance.
So as an example of this type of personality, he watches the townspeople flock to the dead woman in sort of a garbage pile. And he comments as an aside, "Carrion always attract flies." And that's kind of how he talks throughout the movie. So it's easy to see why the townspeople wouldn't be too thrilled about this guy. Duvivier populates his town with all of the French quote-unquote types. The every man and the every woman that inhabits the world, upon which he is now looking down with not so subtle derision. He seems to comment that they travel in packs, sort of like feral dogs, feeding on the power of mindless suggestion. It's a brutal, funny, and deeply felt movie, and I certainly was not prepared for what I was about to watch when I started it.
It has such a gut punch ending, actually kind of a double gut punch ending. Yeah. And it really just left me reeling when I saw it. Something that I did like about it, apart from just the way in which the created reality, the mob mentality thing, just really echoes the way in which reality is manipulated, you know, the claims of fake news and you know, the kind of aspersions being cast against someone regardless of their actual moral character. Something that really stood with me about the film was the mysticism in it. I was really interested by the fact that there's these palm reading scenes that come true, you know, in their own vague way. Mm-hmm. And also the fact that Monsieur here, who is this intellectual who is clearly a very sharp man, how he's interested in astrology and how he casts this birth chart. There's almost this reclusive wizard vibe that he has. Mm-hmm. You know, he's kind of the cynical old sage who's casting judgment on the townspeople. And while he's kind of crabby, I mean, he's not, I don't know, I don't find him all that more grating than a lot of the characters in the film. They're all almost caricatures. And you know, the woman who runs the bar and this slimy boyfriend character, and you know, they all kind of have their foibles. But why is it he among all people, even though he's got a little saltiness in him, but why since birth have people just not liked him? And I feel like there are people like that who just, for whatever reason, there's something that just rubs other people wrong. They might be the gentlest, kindest souls on the planet, or at the very least there might be nothing wrong with them, but there are just some people who kind of get that you want to believe the worst about them, or men or people who are not rationally inclined want to believe the worst about him. So
I think it's because he shirks social conventions, and when a society is based on the upholding of these daily rituals, it's easy to cast him as an outsider or as, you know, the story goes, a murderer, because they did not trust him, because he would not make small talk, because he had no time for them. So he was cast as other.
Right, and he just doesn't participate. Although, right. I mean, I think it's interesting that he gives his backstory about how, I guess we have to take him on his word for it, but he does sort of talk about the time even when he was part of social convention. That kind of, we see him now in this phase where he's renounced all that. But even in the time when he was among people when he was living a conventional life. Even then, it seems like there was like a cross against him. I just kind of was haunted by that thought, that there are just some people who, even when they try, don't really make it into society. So at some point, they just give up and say, all right, fine, believe what you want to about me.
Right, and that's part of the haunting quality of this film, is because when he does reach out, he seeks that mm-hmm. connection with this woman. And that's what ultimately breaks him.
Mm-hmm.
Because he went outside of his predetermined shell. Because even though he had spent so much time resisting connection with other people, he still desperately wanted it.
Mm-hmm. Sincere connection. He doesn't want the glib, you know, how are you, mister, you know, small talk connection, but he wants that deep connection. And in opening up his vulnerability, he also leaves open his unprotected flank to the femme fatale, which is something you never want to do.
You don't want to expose your flanks.
No, just bad form.
And the Duvivier's filmmaking technique here is interesting, because we're including this in the film noir category, but the technique wise, it's more equated with something like poetic realism. I mean, we mentioned Renoir, but there's a lot of that technique in Panique. So the camera movement is very elegant. He was known for using the invisible editing techniques, and there's moments here where the camera seems free to flow through rooms, and there's some nifty editing. I wouldn't call them tricks, because it's methodology about where he cuts and why he cuts. There's also some lap dissolves where images fade together. A whole bunch of crane shots.
Yes.
And it really does create this, I want to reuse the poetry line again, but the filmmaking is a kind of seamless visual poetry. It's going from shot to shot, and where we're seeing these ill-fated schemers and the crassness of Monsieur here, and the way that the townspeople feed off their fear and insecurities, but the camera is showing a softness that's sort of outside all of the characters and the way the action's unfolding on screen. I thought it created a very interesting dichotomy.
Mm. Yes, that although what we're seeing is very cynical and harsh and cruel, right, that the viewpoint is very supple and lyrical, and
lyrical,
makes it all the more poignant, because it's almost, I mean, this is going to sound really like a flight of fancy, but it's almost like this, you know, the viewpoint of an archangel or something, that it's like there, and it senses the infinite misery that humans bring upon themselves and cause on others. Like, it's a very, that's a good point about the way in which the camera is very poetic.
It's a very supernatural camera.
Yes.
Looking down upon the happenings of this town.
It almost reminds me of like what Kurosawa said about Ran, where, you know, he wanted to give the sense that it was a bodhisattva, or it was the Buddha looking down on humanity and crying for all the pain that they created. It's almost like, instead of looking down, the camera is kind of gliding among it all and taking it all in, and allowing us as the viewers to kind of absorb this pain and learn from it. It's beautiful. It's a gorgeous film.
Into a more modern era. So you said to me that you weren't as familiar with some of the neo-noirs. That's not your bag. But I think that any amount of analytical dissection of the film noir conventions more than makes you perfectly adequate in evaluating the neo-noir, because it is really a look back on the noir movement and fast forwarding it to meet the psychological demands of the, well, it's really the 1970s was when it came more into focus, and the neo-noir kind of gets muddied after that. Mm-hmm. Because the 70s style of filmmaking was really the optimum method. We've talked about some of the ways that the elevated gallows unfolds is sort of like improvisation, but the 70s were great for having this freewheeling exercise in filmmaking that wasn't beholden to any particular ideology or seemingly selling to a mass audience, because what we got were some really innovative manipulation of the form. And neo-noir has all of that wrapped around the film noir, shady dealings, dark alleys, all these things come back into play just with a different wrapper. And my absolute favorite is Robert Altman's Long Goodbye, because I think it is kind of the quintessential neo-noir in the way that it takes a classic character, updates it for a modern era, and sort of leaves that old school mentality trapped in the 70s and observing these ridiculous developments in the world. So I think for this one, I'll go first and then you can follow it up, just to mix it up a little bit.
Go for it.
All right. So I picked a movie that is a Brian Sauer favorite. He is one of my favorite podcasters and movie people, does the Pure Cinema Pod. And I've known for a long time that he is a huge fan of Night Moves from 1975, directed by Arthur Penn.
Well, I think Harry would like me to leave.
Well, I don't think that's necessary.
I think Harry thinks it is.
Harry thinks if you call him Harry one more time, he's going to make you eat that cat.
Gene Hackman is Harry Mosby.
Hello, Harry.
In Night Moves.
Well, come on, take a swing at me, Harry, the way Sam Spade would.
He's a private investigator.
My daughter, Deli. Would you believe Delilah?
Well, she's gone.
How long gone?
2 weeks. Go find her.
Making a living.
Well, let's say $125 a day in legitimate expenses.
From other people's lives.
You can get cheaper.
Can I get better? You're hired.
Making a mess of his own.
God, you're really prime, Ellen, you know that? I can't do screwing another guy and you attack my lifestyle!
Your lifestyle has nothing to do with it!
Night Moves. It's a mystery.
I'm looking for Deli Grassner.
Deli isn't around here anymore.
With a suspect. Are also the victims.
I want to know what I walked into.
Ask your wife.
Well, are we going to talk about it?
Well, it's your ball, run with it.
Where the questions.
All right, what's it all about, Mosby?
Is there still much smuggling going on around here?
The dogs have fleas.
Where were you when Kennedy got shot?
Have too many answers. Where every clue is a lie.
I've been listening to your ping pong talk long enough. What was in Marv Ellman's plane? Drugs? Was it drugs?
Night Moves.
Check.
Check. Ah, it's a beauty.
It's a game where every player is a pawn.
Harry Mosby, isn't it?
Every move is a wrong one. And the winner loses everything.
I want to know what it's all about.
I told you what it's all about.
You, what the hell are you all about?
You're asking the wrong question.
Gene Hackman in Night Moves.
And it just popped up in his feed today, actually. I think he was talking about it. So I am happy to say that I finally got around to watching his recommendation. I'd like to give credit where credit is due. And it was everything he said it was and more. So Gene Hackman plays sort of an old-fashioned detective born out of the world inhabited by a Philip Marlowe. Maybe he doesn't want to be, but he's a guy that knows Marlowe socially. Like, he's kind of Marlowe adjacent.
I like that.
The Night Moves looks back lovingly on the format. It's definitely taking conventions, and it's almost trying to act as a, like, holding back of the inevitable future. That's kind of like a crossroads in the 70s. It seemed like there was a lot of that happening. The post-Vietnam, the post-radical movement, it was a brand new world, and there was a part of the world that just didn't want that progress. Gene Hackman plays a character named Mosby, and Mosby's wife wants him to get in with a big, comfortable detective agency that provides job security, maybe some benefits. Who knows? I don't know what the detective agencies were like back then. But Mosby really just wants to operate by his own rules, drive his old Mustang, kind of detect at his leisure. There seems to be really no urgency to his activities. He's offered a job by a former B-movie siren played by Janet Ward, who wants to find her runaway teenage daughter played by Melanie Griffith. But before heading off to uncover the big mystery of the missing teenage daughter, he decides he's going to follow his wife, who asked him to go see she asked him to go see My Night at Maud's, and he says, "I saw a Romero film once. It was kind of like watching paint dry." So he doesn't go along. Instead, tails him and the guy she's going out with, and learns that there is some extramarital affair going on. And this sort of sets the backdrop for the entire movie. The therapy and the release from his problematic home life comes in the form of setting out to do his work. He heads out of town to find the girl. He follows the trail through an old movie set where he meets a crotchety mechanic played by James Woods, and a stunt pilot who sends him off to find the girl in Florida who has apparently been living with her stepfather. And again, like all good noir explanations, that is my stopping point. You don't get any more than that, because the detail anymore would be leading the viewer, and this is a movie that you need to just let unfold. In the back of my mind, as I was watching Night Moves, I couldn't help but think of The Big Sleep. And the knock, obviously, on The Big Sleep is that you can't put the pieces together, no matter how hard you try. And you could do that. It's an option, but you kind of spoil that movie's magic. Like, why it works isn't because there's a sequence of events that surprises you with a twist ending. It's a little twistier than that, and they made changes during filming that directly contributed to the inability to really put that movie together. Night Moves takes a version of that and gives you the impression as you're watching it that this movie also doesn't fit together. You see Hackman's detective stumble and fumble through the mystery, and you don't see any clear path forward, and the scenes sort of stack up on top of each other in haphazard ways, just as he's sort of distracted by his wife's affair, and something's just out of his reach. He doesn't quite understand what's going on. And there's a particular scene in the movie, and this is where the Night Moves comes from, because he's discussing chess. And maybe this has never more been more relevant because of the Queen's Gambit phenomenon happening right now. But it's just one isolated scene where he starts talking about how he enjoys analyzing and looking at chess games, because he wants to see how the end game happens, like how they figured out how to win that game. He doesn't really play chess on his own. It's just something he does while he's waiting, and there's lots of downtime as a detective.
Which is actually something Philip Marlowe does in the books. He plays chess against famous chess players and reviews chess matches, so that's a nice little nod, too, I think, to that.
Our analysis of knight moves rests on this one scene. Because when the movie finally ends and we're still feeling a little bit off kilter, like we can't quite figure out how it got there, that's when you remember that scene and that's when it clicks in. It's not that the answers weren't there. It's that the movie kept us just off balance enough and just distracted, just like our protagonist, that we could never put the pieces together. But they all fit. The more you think about it and the more you go back through the movie, it's kind of a masterwork of pacing and the way that the story gives you its information. You just never quite get there. It reminds me a lot of Gene Hackman's character in The Conversation. About the same time, really. They're a year apart. And they've got the same sense that they're really smart, but the evil that they're fighting, whatever form that takes, is just a little bit smarter.
Right, or that it's elusive and kind of multi-form enough that you can't fight it, that it's all around you and kind of, yeah.
That there's no way to actually win. You're in a game that you can't win. But it was a... It's a fascinating movie to compare to the old film noirs directly, because I habitually throw a few of the neo-noirs as I think of them, and because they're not my go-tos when I think of Noirvember. It's a conscious decision I need to actually sit down and toss them into the queue. So watching this among all of those classic noirs, it really stands out as an informed criticism and almost worship of these sources. And it's very interesting to watch them close together and see how they play off each other.
You know, it's funny. I'm so glad you brought up this title, because it is a neo-noir that I happen to have seen. I watched it actually on Warner Archive Instant, if anybody can remember that far back.
Rest in peace. Was on there, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was on there. And I was like, here it's in the crime section. I've heard good things about it like you had, and I figured I'd check it out. And I think your evocation of how it seems like it's not going to fit together, but it does, and all this work of misdirection that happens in the plot, and largely, like you said, through the pacing, through the way in which it kind of discloses information or doesn't, is really well done. I remember being kind of staggered by what happened in the end and feeling really just a lingering sense of depression and bad feelings after it, which I think was absolutely the intention. So it accomplished that totally. I especially the Melanie Griffiths character and her mother. One of the marks of a really great noir for me is that you get the sense that almost every character could be the star of their own little noir, that maybe we've chosen to focus on the detective, but if we wanted to make it about Carmen Sternwood, her life would be just as noir. If we wanted to make it about Vivian Sternwood, her life would be just as noir. Hell, the father probably has a whole film noir life in him. I mean, just everybody in this movie, you could drill down and they could be the solo character in their own film noir. Everybody in this film is pretty messed up, and I think that it's a similar feel you get with Night Moves, where everybody's got so much baggage. I mean, even the teenage girl has that much baggage. You know, it's a film of people who really are just the pieces don't abide by the rules that they're supposed to. You know, you don't even know what rule book everybody's operating on. Like the scene, the mother, where she talks about her past in Hollywood. Again, I haven't seen this movie probably in 5 years, but I remember a lot of it very, very vividly, and just kind of how sad and bitter it felt, but almost like panique, you know, in the sense that you don't get the feeling that the lens on these lives is cynical. You get the feeling that the lens on these lives is immensely empathetic. And that was another thing that I really liked about it.
And it wasn't cynical. A movie, like this, you would probably imagine would leave you with that empty feeling you get when you watch a movie that is just unabashedly cynical. And you're right, it's absolutely not.
I'm due for a revisit. I'm so glad you brought this one up.
It was another one. I am good at putting movies on the shelf and forgetting they're there when I don't put them in the right place. And this was another one that I needed to dig out finally. But it's so great. Like we have this film community, and we trust each other's opinions pretty much without reservation. So that if someone mentions offhand that they watched this and really liked it, we automatically add it to a list that we are going to get to.
It's a real blessing to have the positive peer pressure to watch some of these films and to fill in the spots that we've left open, because not everybody can see everything. I mean, you don't, and you know, and not everybody should want to see everything. You know, I one time did this little, you know, TCM promo thing where I got to do a Q&A with Eddie Muller, and he asked me if I was a completist, and I kind of said, no, I'm not. And he said, well, I'm not either. And he said, I kind of want to know that there's always something there left for me. I don't want to have seen every Gloria Graham film. I don't want to have seen every Humphrey Bogart film. You know, I don't want to, same thing with me. I don't want to have seen every noir. I mean, and even every neo-noir, because, you know, you say it's not exactly my bag. And I think that's just because the films that I am trying to drill as much into as I can are from the 40s and 50s and even in the 30s. But, you know, I do love this stuff. You know, like Night Moves, or, you know, another film that really surprised me a couple of years ago was Clute, which I kind of always heard about as this Oscar-winning performance. Mm-hmm. You know, it's this, you know, remembered primarily for Jane Fonda. But I watched it and I thought, my goodness, this is an incredible film. And it is so noir. It is such a noir film. It is really borrowing on those tropes and yet doing completely different things with them, where it's the, you know, the investigator, it's the compromised woman, the ambiguous woman, this kind of shadowy killer figure, you know, the trip into the underworld. And yet it was just such a great film that spoke, you know, I kind of had thought that it was primarily remembered only as a vehicle for Jane Fonda, which she's terrific in it, but it really had a lot more to that spoke to me than I even thought. So the great thing is there's always these discoveries there if you just kind of listen and fill in your blind spots, if you remain open to that.
And sometimes it feels like floundering, but that's why we value these connections we have. You know, just that little nudge in the right direction opens up entire new avenues that lead to one film after another. Sometimes, you know, like watching my Duvivier, like I wouldn't have picked it up.
We're bullying you into the Duvivier camp. I know.
I'm back on it, and then I look through the filmography and you know, I was like, oh, this looks interesting. This, because, you know, you just need that nudge sometimes to get you back and going in the right direction.
No, not everybody can see everything. Not everybody can be watching everything all the time. One of the things that I love about the classic film community on social media is that I think, while obviously some people who engage in it are experts, you know, are people who do have a body of work and a lot of scholarship behind them, and they have seen almost everything. I think a lot of us, and, you know, this is certainly the category I put myself in, is that, you know, we're learning in public. You know, we're learning and we're sharing what we're learning with others to help them learn. We're not coming at it from a place of, you know, I know I'm going to share my knowledge with you. More, I'm acquiring knowledge and I want to take you on that journey with me. So that's kind of the approach I try to take.
And that's perfect way to put it. Now you've got one more pick for us.
I do, and I think it fits nicely. You know, our pairings have been very fortuitous tonight, because I think it fits nicely in with Night Moves. And this is Hardcore, Paul Schrader film starring George C. Scott.
A controversial subject. A brilliant actor. A powerful and touching film. A movie which will take you into a world never dealt with in a major motion picture. A father searches for his missing daughter, only to find she has been used in a sordid and shocking way. Nothing you have ever done, seen, or imagined can prepare you for the experience of Hardcore.
Turn it off!
George C. Scott. Hardcore.
Funny story about this film, because even though I just watched it this year, it was actually spoiled for me by the director whom I saw give a talk about film noir in New York City for a wonderful little film noir festival at Columbia University, which is unfortunately didn't happen due to the pandemic, but it's called the Kit Noir Film Festival. Lovely little film festival in the Columbia screening rooms. They get great scholars, great slate of films. And this was at the inaugural Kit Noir Film Festival at Columbia. And they had Paul Schrader there because he wrote a influential essay about film noir, which I highly recommend. And he talked about his work as a noir scholar and also his work as a director who is clearly drawing on film noir. And of course, hardcore as a film that is in dialogue with noir came up. And he talked about the ending. He talked about, you know, how he had originally intended a much more dark ending for the film, but it, in the end, worked out another way. So before I had even seen this film, I knew how it ended. I knew quite a lot about it before I went into it. But in a way, that actually helped me because I didn't go into it with quite the sense of fear as I may have. I just had heard magnificent things about George C. Scott's performance, and I, you know, hardly a surprise because he really was one of the great screen actors, you know, of all time. So I went into it primarily to see his performance, and also because the noir scholar Foster Hirsch had talked about hardcore as a film in dialogue with noir. So it's the story of a very religious Midwestern guy who has a daughter whom he loves and, you know, adores, and she goes on a field trip to California and goes missing. So he hires a private detective played to sleazy perfection by Peter Boyle, who goes after her, comes to the little town and plays what he's seen her in. And that turns out to be a porno film. So there's the very famous scene from Hardcore is where George C. Scott as the father watches his underage daughter in a low budget porno film with two revolting dudes. And it's just like every father's worst nightmare. It is just as raw and uncomfortable and you know, unpleasant as you would expect that scene to be. It's just one of the most viscerally uncomfortable scenes I've mm-hmm. ever seen in a film. It's just really a jewel of make your skin crawl cinema. It's just, and you know, again, even though it's the 70s, there's still comparatively little that you're seeing there, and it's really just Scott reaction is more horrifying than anything you could ever show. It's a really a scene that will be embossed on my memory for a long time. Just so a true. Fantastic performance. Just a gut-wrenching performance. So he turns amateur detective and he goes into LA's porn underbelly. He even dons a fake porn stash and pretends to be a casting for a film of his own. Through that, he finds leads and tracks down some people who you know, had dealings with his daughter. And, you know, although George C. Scott is really magnificent, he is obviously the center of this film, a performance that I hadn't even been on my radar before I watched it was Season Hoobly as the porn actress, sex worker who agrees to be Scott's guide through the porn demimonde of LA, and then I think later San Francisco. I thought her performance was terrific. She was so vulnerable. She was so funny, especially the scene where he explains his Calvinist philosophy, and she's just sort of looking at him like, "What?" she's just Valley Girl enough to be amusing, but with just such a complex inner life to her that she's never a joke. You know, it's kind of her pain that we're left with in a way. You know, the ending wraps up everything more neatly than Schrader wanted it to be wrapped up. But her fate, her uncertainty really, really haunts the film. It's interesting because when I was watching it, I was racking my brains to think, who does she remind me of? Who does this actress remind me of? Because I haven't seen her in anything else, but she's really reminding me of somebody. And I finally figured out who it was. And it was Dorothy Calmengore in Citizen Kane, which I think is notable because Orson Welles said when he was casting the part of Susan Alexander Kane, he auditioned several strippers for the role, that he wanted someone who had that kind of directness and kind of awareness of being looked at, I guess. And I think that that's a little bit of what she has in this, is that she's a woman who is just super duper conscious of like all the sleaziest, dirtiest things that everybody around her is being, can be thinking about her. That she's like, she's without illusion, but that doesn't mean that she can't still be hurt. And it's just a marvelously complex performance. You know, every bit, every inch the equal of Scott's performance, which is really saying something, because he, he's just a titan in this. It's really an incredible film. And it is, of course, kind of a neo-noir riff on The Searchers, where it's the father figure, the patriarch, going after this girl who's gone into a culture that is alien and foreign to him, and kind of finding out a lot about himself through the process. And there's one other little thing that I will flag about it, that I wonder if this was an in-joke by Schrader, because you will see Star Wars being advertised at the Chinese theater in Hollywood. And you see it out his hotel window in LA. And I wonder if that's a bit of a wink at the fact that George Lucas, before he made Star Wars, kind of always said, porn, that's where it's at. That's really what that's the best deal in cinema. Because, you know, you don't, all you need is warm rooms and people, and that's all you need to create something. You know, that's an extremely low overhead way to create spectacle. It's funny that he went the absolute opposite way in terms of creating spectacle. But I always wonder if that little Star Wars nod was a wink at the fact that George Lucas may well have gone into porn had he not hit it big with
Spaceborn.
How far away? Right? Yes.
I certainly wouldn't put it past Paul Schrader there.
It seems he certainly is a very witty, cerebral guy who doesn't do anything by accident. So that's my guess. But what do you think of this film, Jay?
I can't disagree with anything you said. It is. I remember it. It's been a while. I watched it a number of years ago.
You mean you don't watch it every day every year on Father's Day?
Shockingly enough, it is not a repeat performer. It's one of those that's best admired in longer stretches, perhaps. I wouldn't call it a difficult film to watch, but it's not easy either. And my takeaway will always be the George C. Scott performance, and he's someone that I always underestimate, no matter how much I see him. I go into each film like waiting to be impressed by him, and I don't know why. There's no reason for it. You know, he's proved himself time and time again, and it's because that he's more of a chameleon than I give him credit for. He really does bring it almost all the time. Like, it's rare that you see a George C. Scott performance where, like, you know, he kind of half-assed that scene.
He's rarely full body. Underwhelming. Like,
and this movie in particular, I remember it being a very physical George C. Scott performance where every pore is put into action. And I like this one. I picked up the indicator the Blu-ray.
Oh, nice.
And I have yet to really crack it open. Maybe that'll be my reason to revisit, is finally opening that up and checking out what else is on that disc, because it's certain. I'm always interested in a Schrader production, at least as much as I am the movie he made. There always seems to be, you know, stories or something that comes out of that deepen the experience of a Paul Schrader movie.
Yeah, that's an interesting way of looking at it. It was, as you know, my comfort zone is generally earlier than really the start of his film career as a director. So it was really seeing him talk at this festival at Columbia that made me want to learn more about him, want to see more of his films. I had already read his essay on film noir, which is a hoot. You know, he makes this point about even film noir interiors are always lit for night. You get the feeling that if somebody pulled up a drape and daylight came in, everybody would hiss and cover their eyes like Dracula. Like, it's just a really wonderfully witty take on film noir that he wrote, I think, before he ever directed a film. I'd have to double check that, though. And kind of hearing all these little stories and byways. And he really just has an incredibly solid grasp on film history. You know, he teaches, you know, he taught a course at Columbia about how different technological innovations shaped the history of film. He really, for me, his definition of film noir is a little rigid. He does not believe there can be such a thing as a film noir in color. He believes noir is, localized to a certain period in time. So it's a little rigid of a noir definition, but I respect that.
Yeah,
he's a Calvinist. I'm sorry. You're going to have some rigidity when you have that upbringing. Like, that's you're going to be dogmatic about it. That's cool.
Well, have you seen First Reformed?
I haven't seen it yet, but it was right before it was released, and he talked about it. He talked about the way in which, I think, what Bresson film did he cite? I think it was Pickpocket he cited. It was some Bresson film that he cited as kind of the inception of his realization that he could make film, because he thought, well, here's a film about a guy who reads his little notebook, and then he goes out and does something, and then he comes back and he writes about it in his little notebook, and he goes out and does something. And he said, well, that he saw that, and he said, now that's the kind of film I could make. I could make that kind of film. You know, he couldn't make a film like Spielberg made. He didn't feel connection with these kind of more action-packed driven films, kind of almost like we were talking about with the these films that have a looseness or have a structure that is counter to the more traditional, action-driven narratives that we're used to. And from there, that was the birth of a lineage that was, he went through a whole bunch of the films he made. And he said the most recent one, of course, being First Reformed. So I still need to get around to seeing it, maybe for the next Cinema Shame installment. But it's interesting to hear him talk about how the lineage of his films has been through this trope of like, well, I'm going to write a story about a guy who is really in dialogue with himself through his writing, and kind of this film as a meditation, which is interesting. It's not a form you see a lot of when you think about it, but a lot of films, I mean, even noir, a lot of them are tied back to some narrative or to something like that, or some letter or some, district attorney's file. So even that has got a bit of a noirish edge to it.
I consider him a very cerebral writer, but I think he's an even more controlled filmmaker. And when you put those two together, I sometimes he can leave me very cold. But other times those same things that I would use as detractions from some of his movies, like I don't love Cat People, which is something that people love quite a bit, and I just, there's something that's kind of icy about that movie for me that I just don't get into it, but I can still see some of his same approach to filmmaking in something like Light Sleeper. Have you seen Light Sleeper?
No, I actually don't think I have. It was on Criterion Channel for a while, and it was in my queue, but I didn't get around to it. It was one in his lineage of, kind of notebook films, though.
That's the one I would say to you, that this is the one that you should see.
Okay. I will add it to my list. This is the return peer pressure for Panique.
Right. Yes. Light Sleeper is a wonderful, grimy, and if he doesn't call it noir, I will. It's a contemporary, grimy crime noir. Everybody is terrible. Everybody is interesting, and no one is going to end up well. It's three terrific performances in the center of the movie from William Dafoe, Susan Sarandon, and Dana Delaney. The entire cast is good. I mean, it really is a movie built around character. There's a lot to like about Schrader, and that definitely start with Light Sleeper and kind of work your way out. Even American Gigolo, which gets a certain reputation just because of the title and the obvious subject matter is
a Blondie song.
It's and the Giorgio Moroder score, I believe, too. It's a really pretty interesting film. I wish it had better treatment on home video.
It doesn't seem like it gets a lot of attention given the cultural cachet it had upon its release. It
does say it's available currently on Amazon Prime, but there's a lot of those early 80s Schrader movies are very interesting and are certainly worthy of discussion, even when they're not maybe as successful as some of his better ones. And he'll certainly always be known as the Taxi Driver screenwriter and, you know, all these other projects that aren't, you know, Paul Schrader films, but his stamp is all over those movies as well. Filled with noir.
Absolutely, yeah. It was interesting to see how resistant he was to kind of putting them in the noir, you know, even in the noir-infused canon. Well,
he's looking at it in terms of, of the method and the style. And in that respect, no.
Well, I mean, it's certainly one of these cases where, you know, directors are often the worst analysts of their own work. Not in his case, I don't think he's a good analyst of his work. But like, this is what I think about Edgar Ulmer, for instance. You know, what he said about, you know, Detour, that he really loved the character of Al Roberts, that he felt such a sense of kinship with that character that his heart bled for his fate. I watched that movie, I'm all about Vera. I'm like, shut up, Roberts, shut up.
Not many people stop for a guy these days. Afraid of a stick up, maybe.
This buggy belongs to a guy named Haskell. That's not you, mister.
Now, wait a minute.
Shut up. You're a cheap crook and you killed him.
So what else was there to do but hide the body and get away in the car?
I don't like you. I mean, really, like I start saying Vera's lines with her. I feel so much more in tune with her than with Roberts, who to me is just, you just want to slap him. So I don't know.
He's just kind of slime. I don't know. He is.
I mean, yeah. In part is the fact that it is Tom Neal playing it, who really is, you know, was a slimy guy in real life.
Always,
you know, killed his wife, beat up Franchot Tone, stuck his tongue in Ann Savage's ear. He was just a creep. So, I mean, that is certainly adding to my subtext there. But even so, there were plenty of...
I didn't know all of that, and I still thought it was slime. I've read some here and there, but I never...
He was a creep. He was a real creep. And he you know, the animosity between him and Ann Savage was not entirely performed. It was real. She slapped him for that, by the way, for giving her a bad moment. So definitely, it's funny to me the way in which directors are sometimes have a perspective on their work that, you know, it's fascinating, but it's not necessarily how it is experienced. You know, that they're only on the sending side, we're on the receiving side, and that's why it's interesting to get both sides of it. It's interesting to hear about production and intention, but it's also interesting to think about, you know, reaction and resonance and all that stuff.
Yeah, movies have two lives. They have the movie that's seen and presented to the audience, and then there's an entirely different one that takes place in the production.
Oh yes. Or sometimes it doesn't change it at all. Sometimes, I mean, I feel like that's something classic Hollywood people are very good at doing. Like we,
yes,
as a fandom, are very good at, you know, kind of finding out the worst, ickiest things about people whom we love to watch on the screen and kind of going, okay, I'm just going to put that right out of my mind because I'm going to enjoy the film. And it doesn't hurt anybody if I enjoy this film and still know that he was a louse in real life, or, you know, that she was a terrible, terrible person or whatever. So kind of cultivating that duality of, I'm going to enjoy the art. I'm going to not like the artist. It's easier when they're dead, obviously.
Yeah. Well, because then I was just thinking of James Woods and Night Moves, and every time I see a James Woods character, I'm like, you know what? You're pretty much just that awful. Like, all your characters are generally just disgusting humans, and you know what? It's not acting.
I mean, there are actors who do that too. There are actors who just look like angels, and despite the fact that they acted like devils, or vice versa. And then there are people who really, what you saw was what you got with them. They just seemed like a destructive SOB, and that's what they were.
I mean, I can still appreciate, but sometimes it creeps in ways that I'm not too appreciative of. I'm usually pretty good about keeping all that outside the movie itself. I don't,
you know, it depends. It really does depend on how much I like the actor or not.
It's almost just my opinion. We've never been able to overcome the ways that they were branded in their original career. Like, the reevaluation has never managed to overcome some of those standards that they created.
Right. And I think in some cases, like, sometimes the reputation actually hurt some people. Like, a director whom I have come to really respect is William Wyler. And, you know, most people will go, okay, so you respect William Wyler. William Wyler was one of the most respected directors of that time. But I feel like there was a phase there, or at least maybe this was just my perception, that because he was associated with big prestige productions like Mrs. Miniver and The Best Years of Our Lives, not that they're not great films, but he just kind of got so associated with a certain kind of film that his prestige waned, when he was an incredible director. I mean, almost every, I especially going into his early films, has made me think.
Oh, he was very versatile, and he doesn't get enough credit for the breadth of films that he directed. Like you said, he got the Best Years of Our Lives, I think, may have been the worst thing that ever happened to his ongoing,
and Mrs. Miniver too. Again, both great films, but they are such prestige wartime dramas that I think people just kind of think of him as, oh, he's the guy who won people their Oscars with these very, socially conscious, mid-century time capsules. You know, they're much more than that, but I think that's kind of what they get seen as.
And the more versatile directors often never got the credit they deserve because they couldn't be typed. They couldn't be given a style of filmmaking to stick to them.
Mm, for sure.
All right. Well, somewhere in there we ended the podcast.
Well, it is truly after dark now. Maybe we should note that we are recording this podcast long past midnight, which seems like an appropriate time to be concluding a podcast on film noir. I got to go do some crimes.
It's the perfect time. I think my Christmas lights go off at 1 o'clock, so I got 33 more minutes before the really dirty dealings can happen.
Get out your bourbon and wait.
Well, that's a perfect amount of time.
Absolutely.
I have to thank you for coming on the podcast and sharing your love of noir with us. I as I said, I love talking to you, and I just happened to record it for other people to hear this time.
Oh, that makes me feel, again, very warm and fuzzy.
I'm sorry about the warm and fuzzy.
You ended on the wrong note here, my man. No. I love that. Thank you. I love talking to you, too. I'm so glad that since we did not get to see each other at the usual haunts of a TCM Film Festival and Nitrate Show, that we got this...
Some serious withdrawal.
Yeah, this scratched the itch, having a nice 2.5-hour conversation about film noir.
In the history of cinema.
You have chosen wisely.